Telecast is available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma. We welcome you to Birmingham, Alabama, and the historic Legion Field. It is the inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl. The faithful from South Florida and East Carolina have come to watch their respective teams try and win an important football game for the future of each program. The Bulls bring the Big East Freshman of the Year, quarterback Matt Grothy, the leading freshman quarterback in the country. For the Pirates, the electrifying senior wide receiver Andre Allison. South Florida of the Big East, East Carolina, Conference USA, the PapaJohns.com Bowl. In their 10th season, South Florida enters their second consecutive bowl game. Led by the Big East Rookie of the Year, quarterback Matt Grothy, the Bulls can make history winning the program's first bowl game ever. East Carolina is enjoying their first winning season in 6 years. An improvement that has the Pirates Bowl eligible for the first time since 2001. It's a matchup between two programs on the rise. The PapaJohns.com Bowl is next. ESPN Bowl Road Trip continues Birmingham, Alabama for the inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl. And welcome, everybody. This crowd is ready to rock and roll, and so are the Bulls and the Pirates, as two upstart programs in college football are set to meet here today. Hi, everybody. I'm Gary Thorne, along with Andre Ware. Todd Harris will be joining us down on the field. Bowl games, it's an opportunity for a lot of publicity for these schools and a whole lot more when we talk about bowls.
Yeah, Gary, it's a reward for all the hard work you've done in the spring and then the summer two-a-day practices. So it's a reward in that way. As well, it does wonders for a program's recruiting when you can go in and say, hey, we finished the season in a recruit's living room in a bowl game. And then you talk about the icing on the cake for the seniors when they can go out in their final game, which some of them will play their final game this afternoon, and say, we finished it on it with a bowl game. It's a memory that they'll have forever.
And one of the programs that may be the most underlooked but will be seen more than any other over the next decade, University of South Florida. Only 10 years old, but my, what a rise they've had and what a quarterback to grow with.
Yeah, Matt Grothy, their freshman All-American. He's pulled the trigger for them and did some outstanding things all throughout the season. Actually leads this football team in rushing with over 600 yards on the ground. He did it in high school, throwing for over 9,000 and rushing for over 7,000. But on the other side, he's got some help. Three stellar linebackers in the middle. It'll be Big Ben Moffitt, who makes all the calls, gets everybody lined up. Steven Nicholas on the outside has garnered some interest from NFL scouts. They're here to watch him. And then Patrick St. Louis will be the other spark on the other outside. They'll bring it, and they'll bring it all day long.
East Carolina thought they had their program going. Then 02, 03, 04, they only had 7 wins in all of those 3 years. So now, putting it back together again, and they've had a senior quarterback to do it.
Yeah, James Pinckney has been fabulous this season. The first time he actually had a chance to come back to the same offensive system 2 years in a row, had 3 offensive coordinators in a span of 2 seasons, 37 consecutive starts. He's done a magnificent job under the center. He's got help on the outside. Andre Allison, the playmaker, and likes to play under the ESPN lights. We had him earlier this year against West Virginia, 4 receptions, 54 yards, and a touchdown to go along with it. And then in the backfield, Brandon Fraxius took over back there against a good Virginia football team, ran for 104 yards, really when the coaching staff felt like their season took a turn for the better.
These are two programs for which a bowl game is very, very meaningful. When we come back, we're going to look at a head coach who's been the only head coach in the school's history and who has some real emotions about just how they're doing.
The win for your program, perhaps number 7 team in the nation. You've never done that. How do you react to those words?
Well, yeah, it's I don't know. It's a pretty big win. It's a big win. I haven't thought about it, you know. And it's a great win for our team.
Jim Leavitt is the only coach that the Bulls of the University of South Florida have ever had. Emotions, yes, and a big year for them, Todd Harris.
Well, no question about it, Gary. You talk about the heart of a program, Jim Leavitt and South Florida, they go together. You want to build a top-flight football program, you have a limited amount of time and limited funds. Call the best architect in the business right now. That, of course, is Jim Leavitt. Now, he's had his opportunity to go to the quick fixer-uppers. Kansas State wanted him years ago. Alabama's wanted him years ago. But he decided to stay here. He said, I enjoy the process of building, and the job is not done. Even after that big win over then seventh-ranked West Virginia, he said the job is still not done, and he doesn't want to leave here because he says this feels like home. We'll have much more on Coach Leavitt's decision to stay here and why he stayed here and those folks who have influenced him. Gary?
All right. You can see how emotional he was, and indeed for the University of South Florida, this would be a very big win for them if they could put together a bowl victory.
Yeah, you aren't kidding. I mean, he's done a fabulous job in a short period of time. He knocked off Louisville 2 years ago when they were ranked number 8 in the country, and then this year, a good West Virginia team that had a lot of people thinking they were going to go down to the wire, maybe have a chance to play for the national championship game. You cannot say enough about the job that Jim Leavitt has done at South Florida.
Turnovers always play a big part in close games, and there's every reason to believe this could be a very close game, and you see that East Carolina's got a +5 in that department, while South Florida has a -5. Those are the kinds of things that turn into points.
Yeah, I tell you what, it turns into points, it turns into field position, and you look it directly in the eye. Games are won and lost more times than not when teams win the turnover battle, and they've done a fabulous job, Skip Holtz and his staff at East Carolina. It's amazing that South Florida is able to win 8 games with a -5 turnover margin.
It is. All right, these two are ready to go. They have been here enjoying the festivities during this past week, but this is what they've been waiting for, so are their fans. South Florida won the toss. They deferred. East Carolina will be receiving. And as we used to say in the old medium of radio, gotta go right to left on your dial, ladies and gentlemen. It is a beautiful sunny day here in Birmingham, Alabama. The temperatures are going to be in the mid-60s down there on the field. A very light breeze that will be blowing from right to left, but it is not going to affect anything at this moment. Maybe a kick or two, but right now it's a very quiet breeze. Justin Tichy will be doing the kickoff. Jack Hewitt is back, and this will come back to the goal line. Fumbled by Hewitt, picks it up to the 10. Good coverage. He'll only get back to the 14-yard line, first and 10. Let's take a look at the offense.
Hi, I'm Andre Allison, wide receiver, big play guy out of Kannapolis, North Carolina. Starting at O-line, the guy you got to watch out for is pulling around the corner. Is the big guy named Terrence Campbell, a.k.a. Gravy. At the skill position, you have the big play guy, tall 6'4", 6'5", frame, Kevin Roach out of Williamston, North Carolina. And scatting in the backfield is the big play guy, Brandon, California Fractures.
And we thank Andre for that, and you'll be hearing from some of the other players later. Pickney going to the side. That one's going to be deflected. Knocked down and carried up finally to the 18-yard line. Thought that one might not get over there to the receiver, but made it. And for Pinckney, that's a tough reception on the lateral that it is completed. Almost had the defender pick that one off with nobody in front of him.
Yeah, Steven Nicholas, I think, got a hand on that when it was brought down by Carlton Williams, but just got a hand on it, tipped it, but Chris Johnson was able to come up with a reception, and the officials are going to talk about it, and we'll get a ruling pretty quick.
Yeah, I think they're looking as to...
The ball was ruled forward, incomplete pass.
Yeah.
Chris Johnson trying to get a heads-up play there,
yeah,
and say maybe it was thrown behind the line of scrimmage. And you know what? I admire that because you play to the final whistle. So many times guys get caught in between and the whistle had not blown. Hey, play it as if until you hear the whistle and let the officials slow this thing down.
Johnson going out there. Chris Johnson, who is a junior. It'll be a second down and 10. Pinckney on a fumble, and that's going to be recovered by Florida. South Florida recovers the fumble inside the 20-yard line. And there's what we were talking about. Big Ben Moffitt got it.
And already you start to see the effect of this linebacking core for South Florida. The play before, Steven Nicholas getting his hands on it. And then Big Ben Moffitt in the middle of the defense. It gets kicked forward. And right there, Johnny on the spot, the big junior, Ben Moffitt.
Boy, what great field position now for the University of South Florida. Ben Moffitt coming up with the recovery. East Carolina now has had 21 fumbles on the season, and they have lost 11 of them. Matt Grothy, the freshman quarterback, on the carry to the 10, the 5, touchdown! Benjamin Benjamin Williams on the first play from scrimmage for the University of South Florida. A 16-yard touchdown run. Wow.
Boy, what a hole for Benjamin Williams, a walk-on who works his tail off every day. Look at the hole right there. Just a nice running lane for Benjamin Williams to run through. Goes into the end zone untouched.
What a way to start the football game. A fumble, a recovery. We played only a minute seven and already have a score up on the board. The kick is up and it is good. Alvarado with the extra point. And for the University of South Florida, it's as quick as that. Their defense with Moffitt on the recovery on the botch snap. And then Benjamin Williams with a hole that was 8 miles wide.
Things are already different for South Florida. Last year, they were shut out 14-love against NC State in the the bowl down in Charlotte. And right now, off to a fabulous start. They get a turnover. And what do you do when you get turnovers in good field position? Put the football into the end zone.
And that's the third touchdown on the ground that has been scored by Williams this season. Leavitt on the sideline. These coaches haven't even had time to just stop moving as everything has happened so fast early on in that turnover margin we showed you. Well, right now, it's the difference in the football game here in the first couple of minutes.
Yeah, Benjamin Williams saw a little action last year in the Meineke Car Care Bowl, but I tell you what, he has played very well, worked and worked all season long and kind of got himself into that lineup. We mentioned the fact he's a former walk-on or is a walk-on, and they lost Andre Hall this year to graduation, their starting tailback of last year. The coaches absolutely love Benjamin Williams.
And you can see why. He's their second leading rusher. Their quarterback, Matt Grothy, is their leading rusher. Williams is number two in both attempts and yardage gained. Justin Tichy, he's kicking off again already. Hewitt is back again. He gets this one at the goal line. The 10, the 15, the 20, and he will be brought down at the 23-yard line. Let's check on the defense.
How y'all doing out there? My name is Patrick St. Louis, representing Overtime Miami, Florida. I play linebacker number 54, and let me introduce you to my starting lineup. At defense end, I have George Selvey, freshman, All-American, second team. And at the other defense end, we have Josh, the big Haitian Jamis. We have the best linebacking corps in the nation with Ben Moffitt, Steven Nicholas, and me. And at DB, we got them boys that will cover you. You go deep, they will cover you.
And they will get into the backfield, too. That's going to be a loss back to the 20-yard line as George Selvey, whom he was just talking about, their leading tackler for a loss during the year, and Brandon Fractious gets taken down in the backfield.
Yeah, Selvey has just had a tremendous season this year. He had spent some time last fall getting a look at center. Turned out to be a second-team freshman All-American this year. He was second-team All-State in the state of Florida, so a tremendous player, and he's just a redshirt freshman.
Last three on it. It'll be a second down and 13. Fractious, their leading runner in the backfield. They've got three receivers in the short side. Pinckney in the pocket over the middle, incomplete. And Pinckney got some pressure. They're going to use the four down to get to Pinckney in that backfield. He is out of Delray Beach, Florida. The senior quarterback has had a great career, but he's going to see a lot of these linebackers and cornerbacks in this game.
Well, he's going to see a very fast defense and a way to offset that screen passes, draw plays, let the defense be aggressive. They've got tremendous speed. They will come after James Pinckney, handoffs underneath to kind of offset the speed of this South Florida defense.
Third down and 13. This team 44% effective in third down conversions. Pinckney two-step drop, man open, but overthrows all the way up at the 45-yard line. Phillip Henry, they're one of their leading receivers with 34 receptions open, but the ball overthrown.
Yeah, Tyler Roberts in their nickel package. They bring him in, and he blitzes and gets to James Pinckney and didn't allow him to throw an accurate pass. Ben Moffitt was there as well. He's trying to go down the seam and unable to come up with that big play. But I'll tell you what, you're going to have to start completing some passes, short, crisp throws to get James Pinckney and his confidence up early in this football game.
Right now, that offensive line is being beaten by the Bulls' defensive effort. Pinckney 0 for 3 in the air. Ryan Doherty on the punt. And all Conference USA punter, taken up the 32-yard line, brought back to the 40, and Randolph, one of the great returners in the nation, brings it back to the 45-yard line. Randolph, a tremendous returner, gives him good field position, 46-yard punt, 12-yard return. Experience for the players and staffs involve a lot of things like a hypnotist at a local comedy club. How about a bowling challenge won by East Carolina by a total of 50 pins, and they celebrated with a trophy early. A trip to the 16th Street Baptist Church, part of the efforts at segregation in this nation and the civil rights movement. A visit to the local children's hospital. That's all part of the bowl games that are the game and a whole lot more. And right now for USF South Florida, they've got the lead, only their second bowl game ever. They lost last year in their first attempt. And they've got the early lead in this one. Benjamin Williams will be in the backfield. Their young quarterback, Matt Grothy, out of Lakeland, Florida, who is a freshman, has had a magnificent season. The number one freshman quarterback in the country works out of the gun. Carry to the near side, and this is going to be at the line of scrimmage and maybe behind it by a bit. Good play by C.J. Wilson, who moved into the backfield and brought down Williams.
Not only does he know how to play on the field, he's an accomplished pianist. Plays the piano pretty well, and for a big guy, 6'4", all 265 of him, and can really, really move around. Coaches like him, just a freshman.
This rushing game for South Florida averages 143 yards, 50th in the nation. They pass for 225. It is a second down and a 10. Second and 10. Ball at that line of scrimmage where he gets back to. Grothy back. He can run the football. He is their leading rusher. Gets it up to midfield and over, and enough for a first down as he dives away. Let's take a look at this offense.
I'm from Clearwater, Florida. I'm the small center in Division I. I'm here today to talk about the offensive line skill positions. Offensive line, you know, we're a young group, juniors and sophomores. We got a transfer in there. Big, powerful backs that can make you miss and also run through you. Receivers, tall, rangy, fast. And we got the slot receivers who are small and they make you quick, make quick moves in open field. And that's the offensive in the shell for USF, man.
I love the guys. They were great.
Oh, they were.
A lot of players. He didn't quite make the first down. They've got one here. Third and one. That'll be a first down. Nobody in front of him, but he can't keep his feet underneath him when Benjamin Williams. He almost had his second touchdown of the day.
Sometimes those feet work a little faster than the brain, and all of a sudden you start tripping yourself up. But watch it. He's going to have an alley right here along the left side of that offensive front right there. Now you hit it, make one guy miss, and cover the football in traffic, and he's trying to get his feet under him to where he can sprint to the end zone. He was absolutely gone. Nobody in the secondary back there to catch Benjamin Williams had he kept his feet.
Williams got 20 yards on that. He averages only 31 yards a game. He's already there. They bring it around from the far side to the 30-25 down the sideline and out of bounds inside the 20. So they brought that one. Jackson came from the far side. Amari Jackson, who is a junior, he's listed as the X receiver, but he'll carry the football rushing a lot in the game.
Yeah, he was a basketball player in junior college, a former high school quarterback, and he had two touchdowns on reverses last year against Louisville, one that went for 51 yards and another one for 12 yards in that upset when Louisville was ranked eighth in the country.
They are really moving the football. South Florida picking up big chunks of yardage here. Grothy comes near side in the flats, 15. Turned back inside to the 10. A great run after the catch to the 6-yard line by Will Blakey for 13 yards. How about the D?
I'm Casey Ross. I'm from Alachua, Florida. I play cornerback. On the defensive line, we have Mark Robinson, big mean hitting machine. And the linebackers, we have Pierre Bell. And in the secondary, we have the great eight, Travis Williams, Jamar Flournoy, and Pierre Parker. And that is our East Carolina defense.
And boy, are they getting tested early. First down and goal. That'll be taken inside the 5 to the 4-yard line as the University of South Florida looking for another TD. Pierre Bell, the linebacker, put the hit on.
Boy, a guy that's playing really beyond his years in Matt Grothy, who has just been fabulous. Doesn't play like a freshman. He got a chance last year to kind of just sit and watch things as this South Florida team went to a bowl game and took over this year, Legion, in passing, of course, from that position, but running the football with over 600 yards as well. The Big East Freshman of the Year, Matt Grothy.
This is second down and goal. Benjamin Williams in the backfield. They're at the four-yard line. Grothy wants to throw it to the end zone. Gets him at the one and not in. He was down just shy of the goal line. Grothy wants a quick call. Kyle Chase got over there, put the in on Benjamin Williams. What a first quarter Williams is having.
Yeah, Williams is going to come out free to the left flat right here. He's going to just kind of come out and underneath. And Grothy making a nice quick decision. He's got to process things, get the football out quickly when you're down inside the red zone.
Now they'll try for the touchdown out of the backfield to the goal line, and no, I don't think so.
I think they're going to roll him just short of the goal line, about an inch from getting himself in, but tremendous push and penetration. It's about leverage when you're down here along the defensive and offensive lines. You see right there, nice push, but then some creases for East Carolina football defenders to get through, and they get to Benjamin Williams before he gets himself into the end zone.
They brought in their goal line stance team. Now we'll see if this East Carolina defense can stop them. It is a fourth down and goal from inside the one. Fourth and one. They got Williams. Is that long big setback? There he is. Tripped and fell, but did he get in? Yes! Touchdown! Benjamin Williams just by that much, because he almost fell down before he got to the goal line. Instead, he's got his second TD.
Yeah, right here you see the hand on the ground just to kind of balance himself, and he clearly gets into the end zone. I'll tell you, he's not a big guy. When they go short yardage, they bring Walter Walker in and move him around and bring an extra offensive lineman in. Brian Schmidt moves around a little bit. But Benjamin Williams, 5'7", 190 pounds, running between the tackles effectively early in this game for South Florida. And we may take a look at this.
Yeah, I think so, because I'm wondering whether his leg was down before he went into the end zone. Here, the replay is in effect, of course. This is an official review. They want to know whether or not he crossed the line before that knee went down. Did the football cross the line?
You see Grothy here, and he starts to stumble, keeps his feet, and right there he's lunging for the end zone. I think he's going to be in. And I don't know if there's enough video evidence to overrule or overturn the official's ruling on the field, but I think even with that, Benjamin Williams propelled himself in. It looked like the knee was still had a little air under it as he started to stumble. You'll see right there, kind of trips over Matt Grothy, but he's springing in right there as the football comes down. It's in the end zone when he comes down. I think it's going to be ruled a touchdown.
There has to be incontrovertible evidence. It's got to be clear from the replay that the call on the field was wrong before it is overturned. You got to have clear evidence of that. If it's an issue, then whatever the call was on the field stands, and the call on the field was touchdown. They are looking at in the replay booth. They're looking at the same replays that you are looking at right now to determine whether or not he was down before he got in.
Yeah, I think he's just getting enough. The nose of the football crosses the goal line, and when they come back pretty quickly like this, it's usually the play's going to stand.
We'll get the call from the official on this official review, Rick Doan.
After review, there is no evidence to overturn the ruling on the field. Touchdown.
So two TDs on the day for Benjamin Williams, who just made that one. But for the University of South Florida now, two possessions. First one, after they picked up the fumble, they scored on the first play. Williams took it in. He's got 50, there was a 56-yard drive now in the second possession to get their second TD. And East Carolina's got to be wondering, hang on, what's going on here? The extra point is up. Alvarado's got it. It is good for Benjamin Williams. Already five carries, 37 yards, and two touchdowns. Welcome to a bowl game, Benjamin.
ESPN2 College Football, the PapaJohns.com Bowl, is brought to you by Papa John's. Order your next pizza online at PapaJohns.com. Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move through the world. And ESPN Game Plan. Buy your bowl game package on ESPN.com's Game Plan online and catch over 20 bowl games live and on demand.
We welcome you back to the Hall of Fame, which is downtown. Bear Bryant, Alabama Hall of Fame, and here in Birmingham, Alabama. They had a reception there last night for this PapaJohns.com football crowd. All the media covering, the players, coaches, families were there. And right now for East Carolina, they got to find a way to get this thing going. You do not want it set of you. You're looking at this guy kick off for the third time in 6.5 minutes of the first quarter. East Carolina will try it again. They get the ball at the 9-yard line. Chris Johnson, and what coverage. He brings it up over the 20 to the 21-yard line. Big hit by Jerome Murphy out of Elizabeth, New Jersey. Nice coverage on the special teams. 9 plays, 56 yards, 351. Grothy went 2 for 2 in the air. Williams took it into the end zone and had a big 20-yard run as part of the drive as well.
Well, now if you're East Carolina and James Pinkney, you got to start to put positive plays together. Just getting the football, moving the chains, and getting yourself in a position to score. Start to win the field position battle, but you got to have some positive plays happen for you back to back.
This is only their 6th play, and they'll finally get into the positive range in yardage. They were a -1 total of the previous 5 plays. They get that ball up to the 25-yard line. See if they can sustain a little bit here now. That's what needs to be done, and hang on to the football a bit.
Yeah, Dominic Lindsay there, who had missed 5 games against UAB. He went out and now back and ready to go for this bowl game.
He is a sophomore running back. Pinkney on the 2nd down, lobs one to the 50-yard line. It's going to be incomplete. Thought there was a little bump and run going on there, but no call, no pass interference. That'll be just the incomplete pass.
Yeah, start trying to go outside to his big play receiver, Andre Allison, and he started lobbying for that interference call kind of early. Just keep running, allow the officials to call the game. If it's a call, it's going to happen for you. If not, give yourself a chance to make the play down the field and not pull up where you have absolutely no chance of making the catch.
Pinkney is 60% in receptions, has 11 TDs thrown. Pinkney, another lob shot. There's interference there. That is Andre Allison, who was upset the first time doing battle with Mike Jenkins, the speedster. And there was some jersey tugging going on that one.
You could actually call this either way. Yeah. Both guys are pushing and shoving, and I'm not sure how the officials are going to sort this one out. Allison was pushing just about as much as Mike Jenkins was, but the 5-yard bump rule may come into effect here for East Carolina.
Andre Allison is their leading receiver, number 2 for East Carolina. He's got a 68-yard per game average.
Pass interference on the defense, number 4. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
Well, these two guys have been jawing at each other all game long since it started, and you'll see here, just kind of gets his hands on him late in the face right there. That's what drew the attention of the official and drew the flag on Mike Jenkins.
Hey, nice day. How you
doing? They're talking about it. Yeah, I'll be right back.
I'll see you in a minute. Jenkins is one of the players for the Bulls who has sought from the National Football League some recognition on where he might go in the draft process, because Jenkins might go. He is a junior. First down East Carolina's had. Pinkney just grounds that one and gets hit for his effort. He got knocked down after he let the ball go by George Woody there. Woody George, their quick nose tackle, a junior. He was chasing him to the near sideline. Pinkney's now 0 for 5 trying to pass the football.
Boy, Allison and Mike Jenkins right here still going at it as they try to set up the screen, and boy, just battling right there to the bitter end. Nice. Now we're going to have to keep an eye on that little exchange between receiver and corner to that side.
Andre Allison is a senior, kind of losing control out there here in the first quarter. Pinkney back on a 2nd down and 10 over the middle. That one is bumped incomplete. That is the 2nd time a pass from Pinkney has been touched up by the defense. And right now, South Florida defense is just eating up the interior line of East Carolina.
Yeah, I think Patrick St. Louis was the guy that got the big paw on that one. We saw Steven Nicholas earlier in the game. They tried to throw a nice little flare pattern out in the flat, and it got tipped by Steven Nicholas. But there, the other outside talent, Patrick St. Louis, gets his hands on one.
Well, for Pinkney, a tough start. They're averaging 0.3 yards per snap. For East Carolina, they've got a 3rd down play. They did not convert an earlier chance. Taking out of the shotgun with five receivers. Wanted to go deep. Pumps it. He got pressure. Still not to the first down. Gets up there and gets it. Great effort by Pinckney trying to take this offense into his own hands here. Josh Jomiz finally put the hit on him.
Yeah, he's got tremendous rush. A lot of games going on inside by this Florida, South Florida defensive line in there. James Pinckney going to take things on his own shoulders and make a play with his legs. And that's the added dimension that he can give you. Senior quarterback reading and sorting things out down the field. And when it's not there, pull it down, make a nice safe play. Well, that's what we said they had to do. Move the chains with positive plays.
He is their third leading rusher as far as attempts are concerned. Now passing into the middle, open. That'll be caught at the 32-yard line by Jamar Bryant, who has had a thumb and leg problem injury-wise. The freshman playing here for a 16-yard completion.
Yeah, they say he has the best hands on the team. A nice little timed post route, a skinny post, on time with a football. James Pinckney, which gives the play an opportunity to work. When you're on time, getting the football out, the receiver has pushed the corner outside and breaks to the center of the field. Ball's in the air. Nine times out of ten, when all things time up, it's going to be a nice reception.
That was his first completion for Pinckney. You saw Skip Holtz looking on if he can get it going. And that's going nowhere. Right down in the backfield on the attempted reverse all the way back to the 37-yard line. A flag goes down. Andre Allison, and I'll tell you, right now, the extracurricular activities are the reason for this flag.
And it's going on Mike Jenkins' side of the field. It's going to be Steven Rogers, I think, is going to draw the flag here, the attention of the official.
After the play, personal foul on the offense number 83.
Yeah.
That's a 15-yard penalty. First down.
Officials got to get this under control. A lot of chattering going on and some extra hitting.
You know, George Selvey's going to get tremendous penetration up the field, and you see him keep outside leverage, which just kind of kills this play. Not only does he stop and stall the play, goes down on the ground, gets up and makes the tackle as well. They talk about his quickness and speed. He returned a fumble against West Virginia for a touchdown of 9 yards, so he's got nice speed, tremendous quickness for a redshirt freshman.
And with the penalty, big time problems now as they move this ball all the way back into East Carolina territory. The ball will be spotted at the 48-yard line. It is a second down. They have lost 26 on a run, 14 after the penalty was walked off. So they've got a second down and 30. Pinckney trying to pick a bit of it here. And they'll take it back into the Bulls territory at about the 43-yard line, where they'll mark it. That is Allison. He is the primary receiver. Ben Moffitt was on the coverage that time. They want to get Allison the football.
Boy, that penalty really hurts you when you've got things moving. James Pinckney with a nice run, a nice big completion out to the freshman Jamar Bryant, and things are going your way. And then all of a sudden, it kind of deflates you. The penalty, you're moving backwards. Now you got to accommodate for all of that lost yardage and try to force a play to keep the chains moving and pick up a first down.
Third down and 21. Four receivers. Dominic Lindsay, who we saw catch one earlier, has come in here for this third down and long yardage. Pinckney under pressure. And near the first down marker, but he's going to have to gain some yardage. Tried to, but he won't get it. He'll get to about the 24-yard line. That is Bobby Good coming back from a foot injury, but there is a flag down on the play. Shy of a first down by 2 yards. And an ineligible downfield. So right now, East Carolina is its own worst enemy, as they looked like they had the drive going, and now they get a big penalty.
Yeah, Bobby Good's got to run this route, get way down and past the marker. Right there, just going to pull it up short. You see the first down marker here, and he's pulling the comeback route up a little bit short. You want to give yourself, when you catch it, an opportunity to have the first down, or when you catch the football, you're right at the first down marker, so you can fall forward for the first. Don't pull the route up short.
And that will move the football back, and that will bring up another long yardage situation on third down. The ball will be swatted in Bulls territory at the 48-yard line. But it is a third down and 26. Third and 26 for East Carolina. Pinckney's got to get it here. He's going for it all down the sideline, inside the 10, and caught, and touchdown! What a comeback to Bobby Good from James Pinckney!
Boy, this is just throw and catch by receiver and quarterback, and I'm just going to take a shot against Trey Williams on this side. This is just a nine route. I'm going deep, give you a little bit of a stutter, and then I'm going to get outside. What I like about it is he gives his quarterback enough room along the sideline to fade him away from the defender, which makes for the catch right there. Excellent job of concentration with the eyes and then stretching the football into the end zone.
So Good, who had missed time with a foot injury, gets the TD at 48 yards. The kick is up by Ben Hartman. And it is good. The officials move in to stop the chatter of the interior line. That was a third down conversion that ended up being a long bomb up in the air, touchdown catch of 48 yards.
Hi, Papa John here. On behalf of the 90,000 Papa John's team members serving our better ingredients, better pizza throughout the world, and our online ordering service, we're proud to sponsor the inaugural PapaJohns.combo. We admire the hard work and commitment demonstrated by the student athletes in today's game and congratulate both East Carolina and South Florida on a successful season. Most importantly to each of you across the country, our warmest wishes for a safe and happy holiday season.
And we join Papa John extending you all the best. Merry Christmas, happy holidays, everybody. About time Andre and I get out shopping as soon as this game's over. Gotta hit the mall.
Little last minute shopping.
That's right. Take Todd Harris with us. Get some work done here.
Right. He's a shopper extraordinaire.
He is. Great to have you with us here in Birmingham, Alabama for this inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl. And what a comeback on that drive. 9 plays, 79 yards. Took 339 for Good. That is his first touchdown catch of the season. Only his 22nd overall. And in the air, James Pinckney has thrown for 12. Touchdown passes on the year, and that puts him right back in the game. Big plays, turnovers, big plays. Yeah, every coach talk about that all year. They make such a difference in a football game. Ryan Doherty on the short bouncing kick, taken at the 25-yard line. Fumble. No, hang on. He got it. Held on. And up to the 32-yard line. That almost looked like an onside kick. Let's go to the ultimate shopper, Todd Harris.
And for the record, my shopping's been done for days, gentlemen, other than the presents you were going to get. Hey, take a look at Matt Grothy's wrist. Now, you see a lot of athletes who wear the Lance Armstrong Livestrong bracelet. Well, this guy rocks the Livestrong bracelet, but he also runs the Browning Rifles bracelet. I asked him about it the other day. He's the owner of 15 different guns, and the day after Christmas, while the rest of you are taking back the presents I got you, he is going to Ohio to go hunting. Big time hunter. So he's got a gun for an arm. He's got a few guns on the side.
He carries pretty good weapon there. 63% effective at pass completions. Grothy drops back first and 10. And that one got deflected and goes down at the 40-yard line, incomplete. That offensive effort by East Carolina may fire up this East Carolina defense, which to this point has had a struggle.
Yeah, Jay Ross, the freshman, the coaches describe him as one of the best future prospects on the defense. He's a big, big load in the middle at 6'3", 315 pounds. He can really move that frame and get to the quarterback. But I tell you, Matt Grothy right now, just kind of sitting in there. I like the decision maker.
Goes to the flats near side. Flag is down. Wanted a screen here. They're going to try and take it all the way back the other way. This can be dangerous. Brought back up to the 30-yard line and taken down. There's a flag down on the play. And that's at the 37-yard line. Grothy's not happy, and neither is Johnson. Yikes! Now the chatter's not only going between the teams, it's
among them.
It's on the same players going at one another with the same color uniform. And this is going to go against South Florida. Boy, what a start. There's Jim Leavitt over there, 69-43, 10th year, the only coach they've ever had for this program, which is out of Tampa, Florida, some 42,000 students.
Yeah, an illegal shift on South Florida, and you'll see three receivers couldn't decide where they wanted to line up. Officials are still talking about it here, but what a job by Ian Randolph.
Illegal shift against the offense, number 80 and 89 moving at the same time. 5-yard penalty, replay, second down.
Ian Randolph and Johnson.
Yeah, Taurus Johnson, you'll see all three guys here kind of collectively. You see them out here, don't really know where to set themselves. Ian Randolph's the guy that's going to get the football, but right there, they're still moving around. Now the ball's snapped, and that will get a flag every time.
Second down and 16. Passing situation here for Grothy. Walks up, maybe checking off. He has a lot of ad-lib ability out there, and they let him use it. He's going to carry it himself. Quarterback keep to the 30-yard line. He's not even going to be back to the original line of scrimmage. He averages 50 yards a game rushing. He is their leading rusher.
Yeah, Greg Hudson, the defensive coordinator for East Carolina, he's doing a fabulous job. Now you got South Florida where you want them. You can control all that speed on the offense, keep them in long down and distance situations like third down and 12, second and 15. That's when he can disguise things and really give Matt Grothy a lot of different looks defensively.
They're only 39% effective in third down conversions this year. Not a good number. This is the third and 12. They have been much better over the last half dozen games, but on the year, third downs have been a problem, and they got a problem right here. They're having trouble getting their sets. They had five receivers, but Grothy, looking around, didn't like what he saw, so South Florida uses one of their three timeouts. 3:35 left to go in what has been a very interesting first quarter. South Florida had a 14-0 lead, now 14-7. Well, the question is this going to be the day? Bobby Knight has gone through a lot of seasons with a lot of different looks. The one thing that has stayed consistent, some great players, and a lot of wins. And this could be the day that he ties the great Dean Smith. And whatever you may think of Bobby Knight, and there are lots of thoughts about him, you cannot question the fact that they have picked up just a ton of W's. On the brink of history, Texas Tech, their schedule, Bucknell coming up after our game today at 4:30 right here on ESPN2. If they win it, he will tie Dean Smith's record of 879 college victories. Bobby Knight. And we'll talk more about that as we roll along here today. Big third down play. Third down and 12. Long yardage for the South Florida Bulls in their white tops, green uniforms. That one is caught at the 35, well shy of the first down. And this East Carolina defense rose to the occasion. Grothy on the completion to Johnson, but he could not get around and find any running room.
Well, they choose to go soft cover too and just keep things in front of them, keep everything in front of them, and then rally up to the football. And a good job of tackling. Greg Hudson, the defensive coordinator there, he's going to continue to give the young freshman, Matt Grothy, a lot of looks, a lot of man looks there, the soft zone to go along with it. So keep mixing things up, hoping to confuse the youngster.
Justin Tichy will come in for South Florida to do the kicking. He is a sophomore who has averages 38 yards a kick. Defense, pretty good charge. He gets that left-footed boot off. It's inside the 30, taken at the 25-yard line. Good coverage, missed tackle, and out of bounds at the 30. That is Travis Williams, and hello. Before this game is done, we may have a lot of extracurricular activity penalty calls. A 38-yard punt, 5-yard return. There's a lot of stuff going on down there for two teams who don't have really any kind of history with one another. They've played three times and have gone 3-0 in the series. South Florida's won all three of the previous games played and have got the lead here. Jim Leavitt pacing the sidelines, trying to make sure they don't pick up any unnecessary penalties. East Carolina, with 2:40 to go here in the first quarter, takes it over. There you see the last meeting, won by USF 41-17. Brandon Fractious is the running back. They come around from the near side, 30-35, and out of bounds after a first down. That's Bobby Good. Well named today. He's finally found some offense. Mike Jenkins drives him out of bounds. And the Purple have something to cheer for, an 11-yard gain.
Well, you talk about him. He adds an element of speed, and they are happy to have Bobby Good back on this football team. He mentioned the fact he broke his foot and didn't return until the NC State game, which was the final game of the season for East Carolina. But boy, has he stepped up and played big here early in the first quarter.
21 passing, 73 passing, 21 running now for the Purple. It's brought to the 43-yard line, and down there is Brandon Fractious right at the shoe tops on that tackle, Moffitt.
Yeah, Moffitt came into this game with 106 tackles, and he's the glue that kind of holds this entire defense together. We talk about the speed element of this defense for South Florida. Well, Big Ben sitting right in the middle, makes all the calls, runs 4.65 in the 40 himself, but kind of keeps everybody lined up and makes all the adjustments defensively.
Boy, what a linebacking crew.
Oh,
Nicholas Moffitt and St. Louis, whom we talked about at the top. They are 1, 2, 3 in tackles on this team in South Florida. Pinckney wants to pass, and he's going to go down. A quarterback sack back at the 37-yard line, a loss of 6 yards. And that one is Nicholas, one of those linebackers.
Now you're going to see Eric Graham pull from the left guard position, and he just whiffs. And Stephen Nicholas is a guy that has kind of gotten some interest from NFL scouts. He'll have an opportunity playing on Sundays. But I'll tell you what, taking on big Eric Graham, who's been out the last two games with a knee injury, was the starting team starting left tackle when the season started, moved him inside the guard when they got him back in the lineup.
He is all Big East. It is a third down now and 15. Third down and 15. Pinckney deep in the pocket over the middle of an open incomplete near midfield. Andre Allison, had he caught it, he would have had to pick up at least 4 yards running for the first down, but he didn't. It goes incomplete and will bring up a punting situation for East Carolina.
Well, you want to play under the lights. You got to make plays under the lights. And Andre Allison there, a chance to help his team. I still think it's going to be a little bit short of the first down, working against Mike Jenkins. A nice release, gets inside, nice hole in a window. That one you got to come up with. You're going to get hit. Danny Verpale sitting right inside, but you're going to get hit anyway. Go ahead and make the catch.
Ryan Doherty, who does the punting, puts his foot into that one. He is a great kicker, averages 44 yards. The return will be back to the 30, the 35, the 40, up to midfield, down the sideline, and out of bounds. Ian Randolph. We told you about Randolph. He is a magnificent returner, and you see why, as this guy can really turn on the Jets. Taken out of bounds by Casey Ross. Don't forget, the Bowl road trip is going to be continuing. As New Mexico and San Jose State, they'll be playing at 4 o'clock. Tulsa and Utah, that will be coming up at 8 o'clock. Two games, two more to be played today. The New Mexico Bowl, New Mexico and San Jose State, first bowl appearance since 61 and 1990. So two teams with something to show after they've been away from bowl games. On the first and 10, great field position and a great drive straight ahead. That'll be brought up to about the 43-yard line. Finding some room in that middle against the linebackers. Seltzer moved in along with Van Askridge on the hit. Van Askridge, all USA freshman, Conference USA, working out of a linebacker position. Grothy coming up under center. Ricky Ponton has come into the backfield now. Two receivers left side. That'll be brought to the 40-yard line. Not quite enough for the first down. Probably will be marked at about the 39-yard line. The hit by Wendell Chavez, the junior defensive tackle.
Well, it brings up third down and short, and that's a position, if you're Jim Leavitt, that you can live in all game long. Short yardage situations. Quarter's going to come to an end here, but that's where you want to end up. Third down and short in the opponent's end of the field, which gives you the opportunity to make the decision even on fourth down if you want to indeed go for it.
Well, looked like it was going to be a blowout for South Florida. That did not happen. They took the early lead, a fumble, a recovery. Williams took it in for the first touchdown. Williams got the second, but a big 48-yard TD pass has brought East Carolina back. He is Stephen Nicholas. He is all Big East, a big star. Let's meet him.
Oh, man. Growing up with seven brothers, you gotta eat fast. You definitely got to eat fast, and you don't want to be the last one to eat. The games we played was more definitely football, front yard. I was Tom Ratman and LT on defense. Some of my teammates may not know about me is I had a class, a women's communication class, where I had to change gender and I had to wear a dress. And maybe they don't know about that. So that'll probably be it.
I love it.
Oh, that's great.
I love it. You think they know about it now?
I bet you they won't mess with it, though, in that dress, even if he walked into the locker room. But you talk about a guy that has just progressed, was a freshman All-American his freshman year, last year was a second-team All-Big East player, and this year just kept rising. First-team All-Big East, Stephen Nicholas, will play on Sundays. A fabulous talent and a fabulous kid.
Great
to go along with you.
Great kid.
Absolutely.
Talking with him yesterday, I mean, he's intense, but he's got a tremendous sense of humor. All right, second quarter gets underway. We'll start it with a third down play, and that's going to go nowhere. That's going to be all they needed was a yard for the first down. Let's see. It'll depend on the spot here as to whether or not they get it. Pierre Bell, linebacker, has made a couple of big stops on Ricky Ponton.
Yeah, they got him kind of got some penetration up the field. And then Pierre Bell right there able to bring him down. I think he's going to be short. It was a full yard. Officials are going to bring this one in for a measurement, I think. But it was a long yard, and it seemed like Pierre Bell got enough penetration and stopped Ricky Ponton before he was able to pick up the first down.
Didn't have a lot of room there. Let's see where they mark it. I think you can look at that yellow line that, of course, isn't really on the field, superimposed for those of you watching. It's going to be short. So now will come a fourth down, less than a yard, with South Florida having the football at the East Carolina.
Well, they gave him a good spot. You see the seal off on the back, and then Pierre Bell, that is tackling at the finest. You see the ball right there, just short. Good job of spotting it by the officials, and he's going to be just short now. We talked about it. Gives you a lot of options. Fourth down or third and short. You're on the opponent's side of the 50-yard line. You have you can go for it. You can make the decision to go for it up in this football game.
You see in the season, 8 for 18, fourth downs. They are 1 for 1 today in converting those. Grothy waiting for the officials to set the chains on the far side. Has two receivers out there, and will that one running back. Cotton is in the backfield, standing back at about the 45-yard line. Quarterback keeper, and that's going to be enough for the first down. Under Witter's favorite call, Matt Grothy lunges ahead over his center for a first.
You take all that ball handling out of it, where you got quarterback center exchange, that's all you got to worry about, and you're in there snuggled up against the center, and just get pushed by the guard in the center. Get behind those guys and keep your feet moving and push the pile forward. Don't worry about exchanging the mesh point with the running back, all that. Eliminate all that and just push yourself to a first down.
That'll be a triumphant move for the starting center, Capona. Nick Capona is another very funny guy. We talked to him yesterday, the latest center in Division I. They tried to reverse, and not going to work. Taken down for a loss, actually, back at the 38-yard line. That is Taris Johnson. There'll be a loss of one. The wide receiver coming around.
Boy, Van Estridge is a guy on the backside of this who makes the play, turns everything back inside, and then allows guys to make plays for him. But a good job of keeping position on the field. Your job and responsibility, play from outside in and don't let anything get outside of you. He goes inside and bites on the play fake, then he's going to have guys running around him. Excellent job of playing defense.
Keep in mind, he is only a redshirt freshman and made the Conference USA All-Freshman team. Grothy, a little dump pass to the safety valve for the line of scrimmage, Ponton, but that's going to be about it. Ponton was the only man open coming out of the backfield. Fred Wilson made the tackle.
Yeah, the big junior college transfer from Georgia Military Academy. He could play defensive end, but he's fast enough to play in the middle. They've lined him up out there as well, let him rush off the edge, but he is a presence in the middle of that defense for East Carolina.
We get a third down situation.
And once again, third down and long. This is where Greg Hudson loves this defense in, showing a lot of different looks.
1 for 3 third down conversions today. 3 receivers to the near side. All 5 receivers out. Good protection down the sideline. Man open. Touchdown! What a great lead pass to Jackson. Amari Jackson, his third TD catch of the year. Grothy for 37 yards.
Amazing. I mean, right now, Greg Hudson wants to pull what little bit of hair he's got left on that head out, and he doesn't have very much up there. But look at all the deep guys. This is all defensive backs and linebackers. Only 3 guys rushing right here for East Carolina, and you're still able, on a switch route, to get a guy behind the secondary. That is not how the defense is drawn up. You're like supposed to keep guys in front of you and just get deep.
Amazing pass. Boy, was that thing on the money. The extra point is up. Alvarado puts it through. Alvarado on the extra point has missed only one all year. He's doing it today. Look at that. Fully extended on the catch for a 1-7 lead. Greithy has scored his 14th touchdown pass of the season. Jackson got the TD, and he's 5-for-6 now at 62 yards in the air passing.
Well, you're going to see a switch right here where the outside receiver is going to come down on the hash, and then Amari Jackson is going to come down the sideline. The rule in this play is if you're even, you're leaving. He'll get to the depth of the cornerback, and then Matt Grothy going to make eye contact with a safety to this side. It's going to clear itself up, and he's going to make one heck of a football throw for a quarterback, a freshman quarterback. You see it right there. No deep help. He gets to the depth of the corner. Nice pass and nice reception.
And only a freshman. 5-for-6, 62 yards for Grothy in the air. East Carolina gets it back to the 15-yard line. Gets away from one tackler, but ends up going backwards to the 18. Chris Johnson on the carry. East Carolina will take over, and they are down here. Let's get out of Todd Harris. Todd.
Well, Gary, so many people talk about who is Matt Grothy, where did he come from, how did he slip through the cracks. This soft-spoken redshirt freshman is definitely the spark that Coach Jim Leavitt was looking for. But he's not that big of a surprise to those who scouted him in high school at Lake Gibson, where he was twice named to the state's All-State first team. And by the way, he was a finalist for Mr. Florida, finishing ahead of Florida Gator Tim Tebow. So he's in pretty good company coming out of high school.
Kind of got overlooked a bit, they think, in Florida out of Lakeland. He took over in the first game of the season in the second quarter as the starting quarterback. Pinkney, the senior quarterback on the other side. East Carolina first down and 10. They spotted it up to the 23-yard line, down the sideline, and that's going to be incomplete. Pretty good coverage right there by Ryan Gillum, who did not get a call on it, but did bump a little. Steven Rogers, the man he was on.
Well, you see the total offense leaders among freshmen in the country. And right there, Matt Grothy, the leader among freshmen in the country. Just fabulous job this season. 12th, they actually ranked 12th among those guys, but overall. But he has had one heck of a season as a redshirt freshman, 63%. You mentioned that earlier, Gary. That is production with the football.
Brandon Franchus in the backfield as they'll run a couple this time. Derek straight ahead, and this defense of the South Florida Bulls just collides. Allen Prey, who is a junior. They run a lot of people in and out of that interior line. Prey that time coming in, listed as a two deep on the two deep chart, makes the hit.
People that say that momentum doesn't have a place in football, or doesn't make a difference, or it doesn't exist, they got to be crazy. Because you saw how East Carolina responded, even the defense, when James Pinkney went up top to Jamar Bryant. Then you come back, and then South Florida with a big pass out to Jackson from Grothy. Now you see how the defense starts to feed from what the offensive side of the football is doing.
They need it here. Pinkney third down, gets hit. Gets it off, and it's going to be a first down all the way up to the 43-yard line. Kevin Roach, who is a wide receiver senior, three-year letterman, and Pinkney yanks another big pass for 21 yards.
Yeah, he hit Jamar Bryant earlier in this football game for a big one, then Bobby Good on the touchdown pass. But the big fella, Kevin Roach, working himself in, and he's the spread tight end. When they want to line a tight end up in space to get in the middle of the field, they call on Kevin Roach, the possession receiver, at 6'4", 224.
That's a big first down. First down and 10. East Carolina from their own 43-yard line, trying to run outside. No corner to turn for Brandon Franchus. Franchus averages 56 yards a game rushing.
Okay.
4.5 a carry, but nowhere to go as he couldn't get around the corner.
We're going to take another look at the big pass on third down from James Pinkney in the middle of the field to Kevin Roach. And the coaching staff, they like to refer to him as third and Roach, because on third downs, he makes a play for you. See him here working in the middle of the field against a nice soft zone and sits himself down in there. Third down and Roach worked out pretty well.
And he's a big target. He's got size at 6'4", 224. Bring down the second down and 13. And a flag down to mark it. It's still loose out there. And it is. Well, we'll wait on the call here and see who got it. That ball bounced all over the place. Pinkney, I think, finally went back and recovered the fumble for East Carolina.
I always say, Gary, that the good ones and the great ones, this is the difference. Right now, if you're just a good or average running back, you're always looking to break runs instead of allowing them to happen. The great ones, they know when nothing's there, protect the football and take back to the line of scrimmage or a 1-yard gain. You don't create a big situation for your offense where you put the ball on the ground or take a big loss trying to force a big play in the running game.
Brandon Franchus was the man who coughed that one up, and that brings up a third down and a long yardage, third and 23. Back, Pinckney looking to get it all back, and incomplete, almost intercepted at the 55-yard line. Verpeil, Danny Verpeil, almost came up with that one. The sophomore was a free safety.
Yeah, he sat out last season with a foot injury, but this is, you know, it's kind of comical. You say that's why DBs are DBs, is because they can't catch the football. Otherwise, they'd be on the other side of the field playing wide receiver. But that's one he's got to come up with. Sat out all last year, started this football game, has kind of suffered a groin injury that's kept him in and out of the lineup some this year, but they really, really like him back there, his leadership in that secondary.
Verpeil, Ryan Doherty now will come in to do the punting, and Doherty can boot it. Well, he can help you. That one is coming to the near sideline. What a rush put on Doherty. It'll go out of bounds. They're going to mark this way upfield. It's going to be at the 47-yard line. Good pressure on Doherty.
To college football, the PapaJohns.com Bowl is brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, located on the web at mbusa.com. ESPN Game Plan. Buy your bowl game package on ESPN.com's Game Plan online and catch over 20 bowl games live and on demand. And Olivia, redefining high def.
Recognize that helmet in the Alabama Hall of Fame, Bart Starr. A little display just for him. There's the uniform, there's the helmet. Football,
pretty good player,
not bad. He could run a team. And after that 17-yard punt, Rothy's gonna go for the downs. He gets hit. That's up for grabs. Should have been caught and intercepted by Kyle Chase, and he couldn't get it. Dove for it, intended for Johnson, who was downfield, but Grothy had no chance on that one, as it was well short of anybody with the right color uniform.
Well, you talk about Rod Smith, offensive coordinator, really just taking a chance here around midfield with the football, and then a pump fake and going over the top. They are trying to turn the lights out early on this East Carolina defense.
Wendell Chavez, the man who put the pressure on. South Florida's had four possessions. They have scored three touchdowns, and they get the great field position here, and that one's incomplete, and it was red, and there was a chance for an interception. Grothy was going to the flats, trying to hit Amp Hill. The defense had read that, tried to step in front for one of those big interceptions, couldn't get it. It'll bring up a third down and 10. See if the defense can get the job done here. East Carolina, their defense really has been challenged today. Grothy's been able to put the ball on the money for both shot, short, and long yardage. And he'll keep this one again. Calls his own number. He'll be shy of the first down. Not going to get it on that third down and 10. Grothy on the carry.
Well, expect him to go for it again, because they had a situation like this earlier where it was short yardage, and all they were trying to do there on the quarterback draw with Matt Grothy was get him in the neighborhood of the first down marker, which gives Jim Leavitt the flexibility to go for it here on fourth down. They tried it once, and they were successful in this football game. Look for him. Here they go once again.
Grothy's got a fourth down. A fourth down and two. Williams in the backfield, who scored a couple of touchdowns, is back there now, looking for the check on the sideline. Keep an eye on the clock. And they're going to have to take a timeout or take the penalty. They get the timeout. Not happy. Jim Leavitt over there thought he had the play call. Grothy, though, wasn't sure about it, so they'll have a fourth down when we come back. After a rainy day yesterday and last night, a beautiful day here in Birmingham, Alabama, for the inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl. See the crowd on hand here. What the quarterbacks have done for the freshman Grothy, the 62 yards at a TD, the senior Pinckney, 94 yards at a TD. Trying to convert a fourth down. They've done it twice today. Straight ahead on the pass over the middle at the 20, wide open. May have touched down there. Yes, he was. And he tried to turn, but it's enough for the first down. And Grothy comes through again. That is Amp Hill on the 20-yard reception. They are now 3 for 3 today in converting fourth downs.
Well, what it tells me is that they've got a lot of confidence in Matt Grothy. Amp Hill's lined up as the tight end from the left side. You're going to see him drag across the middle of the field and a play fake to go with it. Now, it gives Matt Grothy the opportunity to either run or throw for the first down. He certainly would have gotten it with his legs, but he chooses to flip the football to Amp Hill.
Big offense going here for South Florida so far in this game. They fake the reverse, and it'll be carried nowhere. There'll be a loss. Grothy wanted to take that one straight ahead, but the whole center of the line, Van Eskridge, one of those, a linebacker, moved in on the hit. What a game he's having. What a performance for a redshirt freshman. See why he was all Conference USA, all Frosh team.
Yeah, he's a good football player.
Five tackles.
Hey, you talk about knowing your responsibilities defensively. Van Eskridge has played outstanding. We got a little problem for South Florida because Matt Grothy is the quarterback. He's the guy that's down.
Grothy went out on the right side and tried to stand up, stay up, and then couldn't do it. The starting quarterback, as we said, from the second quarter of the first game, he took over. They've got a veteran quarterback in Padgill Miss, who actually was a starter for this program before Grothy came along.
Kind of got himself bent backwards a little bit. You see the play fake trying to get into the line and right there protect the football. And don't really see anything serious, but he certainly looked like he was in quite a bit of pain. Just hope he's okay.
He got up and started to walk off and then couldn't get there. So Matt Grothy, the freshman quarterback, down on the field for South Florida. Let's get out of Todd Harris. Todd.
Well, Gary, he's been pretty much unscathed this year other than the game you and I did in Cincinnati. You remember that cold night? He took a shot to the nose, 13 stitches to close that gash on his nose, but he did come back, and this time they're going to take him off the field now. He does have to come out for at least one play, but this is a right ankle injury right now they're taking a look at.
That doesn't look very good.
No, not at all. When you can't put much pressure on it, then it certainly is tender, and you see just a tape job, no socks.
So that'll bring in the backup quarterback. The one advantage that most teams don't have is to have a quarterback who's got a lot of experience. And that's exactly what South Florida's got.
He took this team to their first bowl game last year as a starter, and then a deep thigh bruise in the first game allowed Matt Grothy to kind of take over, and he never surrendered the position back to Pat Gilmans.
So let's see how he can run the offense here as he'll come on. In great field position in a second down and 11, a yard loss on that last play. Williams is in the backfield, wants to go to the air, flats near side, great coverage back to the 25-yard line. Johnson made the reception, but he turned around and he got hit immediately.
Yeah,
these flats have been covered.
No matter who the quarterback is, it's just, you know, the timing, the cadence, everything just kind of gets disrupted for the first series or two, and then all of a sudden you'll see Pat Gilmans kind of massage his way into things offensively. But look for them right now, especially early, to struggle maybe a little bit. Kind of surprised me that they open up throwing the football with Pat Gilmans.
That is Josh, his brother, who's a defensive end, cheering on the sideline for his brother who's not quarterback. Third down and 13. East Carolina defense trying to hold here, and there'll not be much gain. They won't get back to the 20-yard line even as they tried to run that on the deep back carry.
Yeah, Rod Smith, the offensive coordinator, and Jim Leavitt choose to play the field position game and not try to force anything down the field where they can still keep a short field goal here on the year. Delbert Alvarado, 4 of 8, 50%. He set a Big East record, though, against Syracuse with a 56-yarder.
This will be a 38-yard attempt for Delbert Alvarado, a freshman. The kicking game has been a problem for South Florida this year. They've gone through two or three kickers. Plenty of leg on that one. It is up and it is good. So Alvarado puts that one through, field goal wise now, 5 for 9, splitting the uprights on a 38-yarder and increasing the lead to 24-7.
How proud are you? How strong are you? How imposing can you be? The best way to prove yourself is to play in a game like this. USC, Michigan. In the granddaddy of them all, the Rose Bowl game, presented by Citi, New Year's Day.
The bowl season well underway, as there are lots of them now. And for the teams, an opportunity to make a mark, not only to end the season, but perhaps even more importantly for the year to come. And for the two teams you're watching here today, it's important on both ends. As this team from East Carolina, they would dearly love, whether their current conference likes it or not, to move into the Big East. They would dearly love to beat a Big East team here. That's going to be taken at the 2-yard line. Chris Johnson, great coverage. They'll get the ball up to about the 14-yard line and brought down. They are all over it here on this coverage. Tyler Roberts out of Orlando, Florida on the hit.
Yeah, I think the story of the first half so far has to be field position. Excellent field position for South Florida. Their average start is the East Carolina 47-yard line. They've scored on 4 of 5 possessions, so only punted the football one time. An excellent position. You see once again East Carolina starting deep, deep on their own end of the field.
The defense of East Carolina has not been able to hold the big play game. Pinckney looking, big rush, not going to get rid of it. Gets hit, driven all the way back to the goal line. It'll be marked where he was first hit, up around the 4-yard line. But big time rush right there, as Bowie, Woody George, and Jill Miss were all in on the action.
Yeah, all three big guys along that defensive front kind of got in there, and he held him a long time with a couple of pump fakes. But after about the second pump fake, it better be going somewhere. Otherwise, you're going to have some couple of 300 pounders laying in your lap.
This offensive line is having its problems providing protection.
Now you can help them out. If you get back, get set, and get the football out, you don't have to take sacks like the one that James Pinckney just took.
That was a loss of 9 on that sack. Out of the end zone now. Pinckney looking, gets rushed. He'll get back to the 5-yard line, still on his feet at the 9, and that's where he'll be taken down. He decided not to go out of bounds. Ben Moffitt made the hit. Pinckney will be shy of a first down. He needed to get up to about the 14-yard line.
Yeah, and the reason why you don't want to take that sack, or you don't have to, throw the football away, and you're deep on your end of the field. Now, you got to dig yourself. You're already in a hole. When you're inside your own 15-yard line, you're in a hole. You got to get back, make quick decisions, and get the football out. Otherwise, you're chasing the chains, chasing the down and distance, which puts them in this third down and 13 situation.
Skip Holt, second year, 12-11. Here at East Carolina, hoping his team could come out here against South Florida, the favorite, and get on top. They didn't do that. Now battling back from a bigger deficit from his own 4, completes that one out of bounds at the 26 to Allison. And that will be enough for a first down. Allison made sure this time he went beyond that first down marker.
Well, a good job of pushing Mike Jenkins off and Andre Allison right along that sideline, and he gets good depth for the first down so that when he catches the football, he's already at the first down marker. And a fabulous throw low and outside away from the defender by James Pinckney.
15-yard gain. That gives him a little breathing room as he had to do that out of the end zone. Allison now a couple of catches for 29 yards in the game. They've moved the linebackers defensively up into those slots. Pinckney turns near side, big run, dumps it off, and down at the 24-yard line is Allison again, who cut back towards the middle of the field from his wide receiver spot.
Which is a no-no, because you want to get north and south as soon as you get the football. You make the catch, you get up the field north and south, as opposed to going laterally back inside. There's only trouble coming from in there. The wide body guys are lie inside, and they eat and kind of fester around the middle of the field.
Got that ball back to the original line of scrimmage, where it'll bring up a second down and 10 now. East Carolina in their own territory. Those 4 down linemen for South Florida put the pressure on. Dominic Lindsay has come in a receiver. Out of the pocket over the middle. That one's going to be incomplete. And we'll check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
Gary, coming up on the Smith-Barney halftime report, we just saw Andre Allison get the ball. We'll talk about some of the other great receivers in the bowl season, ones that you should be looking forward to. We'll also, since it's the season to feel good, deliver the feel-good stories of the bowl season and a great college basketball game between Texas and Tennessee going to the end. We might even see if Father Knows Best with a little advice for Skip Holtz at halftime.
A coming up. Dad is watching this game with Skip Holtz, the coach here, East Carolina. Lou back in our studio. Pinckney's now 6 for 16. One touchdown. Pinckney looking deep and intercepted at the 41-yard line. Verpale, who's had a big series intended for Allison, who probably should have had it.
Probably. There's no doubt that he should have made this catch. A good job of pushing him off, pushing Mike Jenkins off, and then settling. That's just concentration. Takes his eyes off the football, and we'll see if Danny Verpale comes up with this or if he traps it with the turf here. But right there, nice throw. You got to make the catch. The defender's inside throws it just slightly behind him to kind of alleviate the big lick from Danny Verpale. And boy, that's one Andre Allison wishes that he had back.
That's a big turnover on the interception. Now they're going to stop it here. All plays are subject to review. They look at them all.
I'm thinking they're going to overturn this one. This one's going to go back to East Carolina because it looks like the football was clearly trapped. You'll see it right here. Come into your screen. The tip by Andre Allison, and right there it hits the ground and is trapped. He rolls over on it. I'm thinking this one's going back over to East Carolina. They're going to get the football back to punt it.
Is there indisputable evidence that the call on the field was wrong? Must be indisputable.
Nice acrobatic catch, but the ball touches before he has possession of it.
Looks like he tried to bury the point of it in order to get a good handle. Good effort that time, but we'll wait and see whether or not they get the ball back. Otherwise, would be another great field position turnover for South Florida.
Well, I've been where James Pinckney is right now. You're getting tremendous pass rush, and you're sitting in there, and you're battling, and all you want is for one guy or two guys to make a play for you, and you're hitting them in the hands, and they keep putting it on the ground. Well, he needs to go over and have a little talk with Andre Allison. My buddy Jason Phillips remembers a couple of talks that we've had. weren't too kind.
Would you mind hanging on to the football when I throw it in your hands?
Not in those exact words.
Oh, okay.
Close, but not exactly.
It's a family show. It's a holiday
season.
And you know what?
I love him to death. And he knows it.
All right, let's see what they're taking a while here because, again, you've got to have that indisputable evidence that the call on the field was wrong. That's the key to this. It's the burden of proof for all of you attorneys out there that decides this issue. It is not judged anew by the replay official. It's whether or not
we've made our decision, haven't we?
We've made our decision, and it doesn't matter a darn. Jim Leavitt and Skip Holtz
waiting. When they come back quickly, it's usually the decision on the field is going to be uphill. Now, when they come back, when they take a little while to come out of it, now they're trying to figure out where the ball is going to be spotted, how to move the chains back, and all that stuff. So we'll see. I believe this is going to be overturned.
Either that or he didn't finish his Christmas shopping. Or he may be ordering that Papa John's
pizza online. That's right. He's got somebody working a computer somewhere.
Yeah, they got the computer upstairs here, and they're ordering online. We knew what was going on. That is Pinckney on the sideline. James Pinckney, the quarterback for East Carolina. So both quarterbacks have had medical problems here in the first half. Did you know you can order Papa John's pizza online? Huh? Did you know that? Okay, come on down here, Big Papa. Now, come on. It's almost halftime. Hey, nice to meet you. How are you? Pleasure.
Tell you what, delivered to the booth. That's
look
nice.
Look at this.
That's nice. That's good
look
stuff.
At this. Papa John Schnatter just brought this one in. Thank you very much.
Beautiful. National pizza company you can order online.
Have we heard? Yes.
West, the team at IS do a great job.
And every one of your franchises you can order online nationwide, right?
That's great.
And we didn't even have to order online. All we had to do was get the owner there.
Prior to possession, incomplete pass. Fourth down at the 25-yard line.
Yeah, they overruled it, and now it's going to be a punting situation for East Carolina. But we thought that football was trapped. It hit the ground, and Danny Verpale, well, I tell you what, good job of acting on his part of trying to roll over and convince.
Do we hurry this half up? We got 3:30 left to go here, and I don't want those pizzas to be
get
hot.
Cold. Huh? You're ready to get to those pizzas. I hear you.
We thank Papa for bringing those down. The inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl, of course, is where we are. Now there you see Pinckney being looked at here. That's the kind of thing you do if you think you got a little concussion
took
going.
Took a shot.
There is Cass, the backup quarterback, Rob Cass, redshirted freshman who has not played this season very much. may get an opportunity here in this game.
He's only thrown 11 passes on the season, 36%, 4 of 11, 46 yards and an interception. So not a whole lot of experience behind James Pinckney.
And Ryan Doherty will come on to do the punting. The last time he got a tremendous rush and booted one that went only 17 yards on his last kick. He averages 44. His longest kick has been one of those rolling donuts that went 72 yards. Doherty is a class punter, as we told you. This guy can boot the football and has done a has played a major role for the Purple in keeping themselves a good field position. And he gets that one off. He got all of it all the way back to the 16-yard line. The return will be shy of the 25 by Ian Randolph. The booming punt of 59 yards for Doherty and a 7-yard return for Randolph.
Let's take a look here and see what happened to James Pinckney on that last play. He was in the ballgame. You see him right here trying to go down the field to Andre Allison. Gets the ball off. Just a nice little shove, and then that was the one right there. The little shoulder pad into the side of the head. It was Aaron Harris who kind of showed up a little bit late on James Pinckney.
Well, the other quarterback is back. Matt Grothy, who went out with what looked like a twisted ankle, is not going to miss any more time. He comes out with Benjamin Williams in the backfield with him. On the carry, Williams will struggle ahead on a good effort up to the 28-yard line. Let's check in with Todd Harris. Todd.
Well, Gary, the official word, not an ankle on Matt Grothy. Someone stepped on his shin bone, which not a whole lot of meat on those shin bones, so they've got a pretty heavy wrap on there. He is going to go as long as he can. They'll reevaluate him when he gets in the locker room at halftime.
See how he can move out there with that shin bone obviously bruised. This will bring up a second down as University of South Florida back in their own territory on a second down and 5. Two receivers to the right side. Williams on the carry, and he booms himself up to the 35-yard line. Benjamin Williams is having his best day of the season and probably of his career here today. I mean, he went over the average rushing yardage in a game that he has in the first quarter.
Yeah, and he played in high school for Chad Barnard at Lake Wales High School. It was actually University of South Florida's first quarterback. So he's done a pretty good job here in this game.
First and 10, Grothy's going to get sacked back to the 25-yard line. He had nobody open. C.J. Wilson got through, and their leading sack man at 3 in the year gets Grothy, and he's limping a little more. We talked about Williams, 7 carries, 49 yards total already here in the first half, and a couple of touchdowns that he's put across. This one came after the fumble recovery, their first play from scrimmage, 16-yard run. Next time around, he went in on a 1-yard dive after he'd been involved in a drive where he also gained 20 on a run. So for Benjamin Williams, the sophomore, big day.
I'll look for them to go back to him. You see the average per carry there at 7 yards. And when they give the football to Benjamin Williams, good things happen. And you saw the last play when they go away from him. Matt Grothy takes the big sack. Look, his mobility won't allow him. Todd talked about that shin injury. But it won't allow him to make plays like he has coming into this football game. So they'll rely a little bit more on Benjamin Williams.
Let's take a look at our bowl schedule coming up today. Google's going to help us out here. Let's start where we are. Birmingham, Alabama. The bowl week road trip's going to continue later on today. Take you a little further west. Albuquerque, New Mexico. The New Mexico Bowl. And then tonight, Fort Worth, Texas. And the Armed Forces Bowl will be taking place. You got to see at 4:30. New Mexico, San Jose State at 8 o'clock tonight. Tulsa and Utah, the New Mexico Bowl and the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl, all coming up today. 24-7, South Florida with the lead in this one. They had a 14-0 lead, was 14-7, and then they have added to it. South Florida going 8-4 overall, 4-3 in the Big East this year. And they've got the football with a second down and long yardage. Second down at 18, a little over 2 minutes left to go here in the first half. Grothy looking downfield, slings that one. It'll be incomplete. May have been caught, but it was out of bounds as Edwards tried to straddle a line over there but couldn't do it. Pretty good coverage by Casey Ross.
Boy, that ankle injury, the shin injury of Matt Grothy right around the lower part of the leg. Nice throw, just got to come up with that catch, but he certainly doesn't have the mobility that he had when he started this football game, really limping badly on that right leg. But nice throw right there. Excellent job of kind of getting a hand in there was Casey Ross, one of their senior leaders on this side of the football, on the defensive side of the football.
More Grothy, 6 for 10, 81 yards and a TD for the quarterback. This is a third down and long yardage. Flag goes down. Williams on the run. Look at him scoot over the 40-yard line. He will be shy of a first down, but what a day. Travis Williams on the hit. This may come back, though, with the flag.
Well, we talked about good things happening when you give it to Benjamin Williams, but I think this one's going to be holding on one of the big guys up front for South Florida. Actually, illegal shift. That's a couple of times in this football game that that's happened to Jim Leavitt and his offensive unit.
They've not been able to get set. And before we go any further, I want to make sure that we send out our condolences. Missing this game is Wally Burnham, who is the South Florida defensive coach, defensive coordinator. His mom, Cora, passed away early this morning. He is not here. We send our condolences to he and his family.
Absolutely.
And wish them well. Very tough. A wonderful man, Wally Burnham, who has headed up the defensive coaching job and given great credit by Jim Leavitt for all the work that's gone on here. He went home yesterday, hoped he was going to be able to get back today. But with his mom passing away, he is missing this football game.
I got a chance to speak with him earlier in the week and in the last season as well, doing seeing South Florida against North Carolina State, and we certainly wish him well.
Grothy's gone out of the game. That shin is bothering him. So here in this third down and 23, Gomez is back in at quarterback. Second time he's been in here in this game, the senior quarterback, a veteran. Third down and 23. This is a big play. Going to kind of run an option that goes absolutely nowhere. With a minute 43 left to go, Marcus Hands making that tackle for the defense. East Carolina's got a chance to get this football back. They've got a couple of timeouts remaining. They get a chance to put some points up on the board before the half ends.
Yeah, two timeouts with a minute 41, and the clock's going to stop every time they're able to pick up a first down. Even on a punt here, they're going to get some excellent field position. So, Gary, that's an eternity.
Yep.
141 with two timeouts, that is a long time for Skip Holtz and his offense to have an opportunity to pick up some points here going into halftime.
They are going to use one of their two timeouts right here, East Carolina is, in order to stop the clock before the punt. With a minute 41 left to go, give themselves a chance maybe to get a TD up on the board. Skip Holtz, of course, awarded a new contract this past week. With all of the coaching carousels that's been going and expected to heat up even more once the bowl season is over, they wanted to make sure in East Carolina they were able to keep him. And this coaching skyrocketing money and terms wise of years continues, and he's the latest beneficiary of an extended deal.
Now they wanted to make sure they kept him in place and to continue to build on what he's doing. 12 and 11 in two seasons at ACU. He's got a very young football team. 75 of 111 players are either freshmen or sophomores. That is some nice future prospects that come up, and I'll tell you what, he's going to do a heck of a job of getting this program pointed in the right direction. He already has.
Justin Teach is going to do the kicking. Gets the foot into that at the 12-yard line. It'll be taken back at the 31 by Travis Williams. Gets a little roam up to the 40, 45, and close to midfield and over it. That is exactly what East Carolina needed. A good return before Blakely can drive him out of bounds. A 44-yard punt and a 17-yard return. And now East Carolina, with one timeout left, has a minute 29 to work.
Well, what a difference it makes when that old field position battle kind of changes into your favor. Excellent field position in which to start here at the 50-yard line for East Carolina. 1:29 left on the clock with a timeout. That's a plenty of time for James Pinckney to get his offense in a position to score.
And Pinckney is back in there at quarterback after being looked at on the sideline. He's out of that gun. First down and 10 over the middle. It is incomplete. He had a couple of receivers near the 40-yard line, and that actually split everybody. Well, that'll stop the clock on the incomplete pass.
They tried to go to Chris Johnson, who was actually a tailback earlier in the season, and talking to Coach Holtz, he said, well, he's so talented, we just had to find a way to get him on the field. And Fractious really came on at one point in the season against Virginia and kind of took over that role as the team starting running back. So Chris Johnson, they moved into the slot just to keep him on the field.
A second down and a 10. Plenty of time left here. 6 for 18 in the air, trying to pass again, and he's going to get sacked back at the 45-yard line. Wow.
What's the number
South
one
Florida,
rule?
That is the third sack they've recorded.
What's the number one rule in the two-minute drill, Gary?
Get rid of that football.
Yeah, don't take a sack in the two-minute drill, because all of a sudden now you're fighting the down and distance again, and the clock starts to work in your opponent's favor.
Chris Robinson, the tackler, is their leading sack man for the South Florida team this year. Now it is a third down. Pinkney again over the middle, and that's going to be incomplete and almost intercepted again. Rapale has had more of a chance to receive Pinkney passes than some of Pinkney's own receivers.
Well, now you're in a situation with 41 seconds left, and the position on the field, you've gone backwards. Now you got to punt the football, but South Florida now has an opportunity with a timeout left. Right here, Danny Rapale almost, makes one heck of a break on the football. He's had his hands on a couple that actually should have been interceptions.
Rapel's had a strong day in that secondary, and there's a wasted opportunity for East Carolina. And watch out for Randolph. He can return, sixth in the NCAA, as you saw, and return yardage. Another strong boot is going to take a bounce. Randolph will watch it roll, and will go inside the 10 and the 5. And all the way down to the 1 yard line with 27 seconds, 26 seconds remaining to go. That'll be a 54-yard kick by Ryan Doherty.
Well, it's so deep that you can't even kneel it down.
No.
You'd be kneeling down for a safety. So you kind of just, you know, run Pat Gilchrist into that line and or hand turn it around. I wouldn't even turn around and hand it off, because if you get some penetration and all of a sudden somebody gets a hand on the football, it could get ugly back here. But I'd run a quarterback sneak and just let this clock run out.
There you see the five punts, almost 44 yards a kick. Now the D would love to be able to spring a ball loose here and recover it close enough to the end zone to put the pressure on and for South Florida to protect that football.
Man, there's a lesson for all backup quarterbacks. You never know when you're going to be in a football game. Always have to be mentally ready, mentally sharp, and keep yourself ready to go.
We'll see whether or not Grothy for South Florida can get back in the football game second half. Gilchrist will just carry that one straight ahead for a couple of yards, and that will do it here in the first half. So the inaugural first half of the PapaJohns.com Bowl is a good one, and for South Florida in particular, the offense got rolling early. It was 14-0. It was 14-7. They've got a 24-7 halftime lead. Todd.
Coach, with a 24-7 lead, do you need to make any changes in the second half?
Well, you know, they hit the one deep ball, which was a really good throw. I thought Trey was on him pretty good. They're throwing some balls in the middle. We're not getting real good coverage, but I know our linebackers are sitting on the run game a little bit. You know, we need to continue to move the ball. This is a very good football team. You're not in a bowl game if you're not be good. They're very explosive. Obviously, Pinkney is showing that he can throw the ball well. We got to play 60 minutes of football.
Do you know the status of your young quarterback?
But he doesn't look like everybody else will see the same thing I do. He doesn't look like he's feeling very good in that leg.
Any thoughts you want to send out to your defensive coordinator, Wally Burnham?
Yeah, we just love him. He's the best. He's the best.
Thanks, okay. Coach.
Well, the defense has gotten it done as well as the offense in this game. 24-7 first half, South Florida leading. Reese, Mark, Lou, and Doug standing by our Smith Barney halftime report.
All right, Gary, running down the entire roster there. 24-7 lead for South Florida. And, you know, the last time East Carolina was in a bowl game, they had a 38-8 lead at halftime and lost 64-61 to Marshall. But in East Carolina, I don't know if they're going to bring Byron Leftwich out for the second half. What do you see from the first half from Skip's Pirates, Luke?
Well, number one, you have to be very physical when you play the game of football. And the offensive line of East Carolina is just getting beaten badly by South Florida. In addition to that, South Florida is there to win. This is for East Carolina's first trip to a bowl game in quite a while. And they're just sort of going through the motions. Not that they don't want to win. They're turning the ball over. They're doing the things that they didn't do during the course of the year. They're doing the things. If they'd done these during the course of the year, they wouldn't be in a bowl game. However, they do have a chance to bounce back, but not unless the offensive line starts protecting them and giving the running backs a little bit of running room.
What would you say?
What would you say to a team that was in this situation at halftime if you were in Skip's shoes right now?
Well, I'd say, let's stop talking and let's start playing. See what happens when you talk to the other team. You talk to the defensive back. You give this jaw to jaw. You lose your focus. Then they're dropping passes all over. Let's go play the game. Forget about the score. Let's go play our football game, and let's most importantly understand it. We can only score one touchdown at a time. We can't go out there and get two touchdowns on one play. Let's go play. Play by play, get 7 points, 7 points, 7 points, but let's start playing physical. That's why you got pads on. You don't want to play with pads on?
Wound up.
You got a whistle?
Are you ready to go?
You go get him, coach.
I almost had to call time out.
Go get him, coach.
There was a filibuster on the floor of my studio set. South Florida with a 24-7 lead over East Carolina. When we come back on the Smith-Barney Halftime Report, the good hands men. Bowl season will tell you who the best deep threat is, which team has the best receiving core, who we expect to make the biggest plays when we come back.
This halftime report is brought to you by Smith Barney. Come to Smith Barney, where wealth works.
East Carolina's Andre Allison hasn't had a big half, only three catches, but he does have the attention of the pros. Todd McShay from Scouts Incorporated on the prospects for the Pirate receiver.
East Carolina wide receiver Andre Allison has had a tremendous senior season. He came in very inconsistent, but scouts have always loved his athleticism and his overall speed. Now, he doesn't have great size, he's about 6 foot, 190 pounds, but he's going to run in the 4.3s or maybe the low 4.4s, and he makes a lot of big plays. He had 59 catches during the regular season this year. If he improves as a route runner at the next level, I think Allison can become a number two starter. That's why I think you'll see him drop to the second level once some of these junior receivers come out. But that's a great pick for an East Carolina program that hasn't had a player pick that high in a long time.
It is the inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl here in Birmingham, Alabama, where South Florida's got a 24-7 lead as the Bulls have had the offense and the defense working. Welcome back, everybody. I'm Gary Thorne with Andre Ware, Todd Harris with us down at the field level. The inability of East Carolina to move the football on the ground, a minus yardage, minus six in that first half, has really nullified their offense.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head. They've got to find a way to run the football. Otherwise, there's going to be heat on James Pinckney all of this second half as well. They've got to find a way to change the field position battle where it favors them, and that means special teams going to really have to step up for East Carolina. If you're South Florida, just keep doing what you're doing. Keep bringing the heat as well, and then rely on Benjamin Williams a little bit more. When they give him the football, good things have happened.
Now, we may have a change in that regard because it looks like their freshman quarterback for the Bulls is not going to play. Grothy looks like he's going to be out of there. What kind of an impact?
Yeah, Pat Jumas. Look for him, like I said, to rely on Benjamin Williams a lot in the second half of this football game with Matt Grothy out of the lineup, as well as some quick, crisp, safe throws for Pat Jumas.
There is Grothy, who came out with that leg wrapped up where he had the shin that was injured in the first half, and obviously helmet has been taken off, so he's going to become a spectator. Their young freshman quarterback will spend the rest of the time over there on the sidelines here for this bowl game, as the Bulls of South Florida are looking to win their first bowl game, and this is their second bowl appearance. The first one was last year, and they suffered a loss. They've got the lead in this one, and they have dominated. We'll see if East Carolina get back into it. A bouncing kickoff that'll be handled at the 17 and returned up to about the 29-yard line. Flag goes down on the play as well on the near side. Pretty good field position on that. Let's go downstairs, Todd Harris.
Well, Gary, just breaking news moments ago. The folks at University of South Florida told me Matt Grothy is done for the day because he has a hairline fracture in that right shin bone. So what was initially was reported as just a bruise in the shin bone, obviously much worse. He's in a walking cast. He is done for the day. Gary?
That's hard. You work all season long. Yeah. Even if you are a freshman, you're going to get more chances.
There's no foul on the play.
Flag will be picked up. No foul called. So Matt Grothy out of there. Will that make a difference in this football game? That's something we're going to find out.
I think it changes their whole offensive outlook. Last year, they were a spread offense with a concentration on really running the football. When they had Matt Grothy in the lineup, they were a lot more balanced. They attacked you more through the air. So look for them to go back to running the football here in the second half.
There is Williams in that backfield, who's had a great day. He will carry for maybe a yard. He has been their leading rusher here today. 7 carries, 49 yards, and 2 TDs in that first half. And they go to him on the very first play here of the second half.
Yeah, he's going to have to be the workhorse in this second half for South Florida offensively. And until Pat Jumas gets himself kind of massaged into this game and gets his feet under him in the pass game to where they can rely on him to make plays with his arm.
It'll bring up a second down and 8. Give him 2 out of the gun. They fake to Williams, try the flats. This hasn't worked all day, and it's not going to work here either. Unless he can make something out of nothing, and he does, to the 30, 35, 40, and all the way up to midfield. That'll show you. That is Ian Randolph, who got the ball on the near side, had nowhere to go, goes to the other side of the field and gets 21 yards.
Well, when you talk to the coaches and players about Ian Randolph, all they talk about is his great quickness and ability to make the first guy miss. And that's what he does to Casey Ross. Then he turns it back and everybody picks up a block. Look at the receivers blocking out in front of him. Not a tremendous speedster, but he's got great quickness, which allows him to make plays like that.
Boy, there was some hit put over there on Travis Williams, the cornerback, who got leveled over there on the far side. Carried straight ahead after that pickup of the first down. It'll be brought to about the 45-yard line. Benjamin Williams again on the carry. This is going to be a career day, for the moment at least, for this sophomore running back. And they will want to run some of this clock down with the 24-7 lead, as South Florida would like to keep possession, keep the clock going.
Well, we saw Greg Hudson earlier go to a softer zone and merely mix coverages. Now he's got a lot of bodies around the line of scrimmage anticipating Benjamin Williams to get the football.
Williams, they fake to him. Gilmes passes near the first down marker, out of bounds. He'll be shy of it up near the 40-yard line. That is Hill. Here's the young quarterback.
Yeah, let's go back and take a look at what happened to Matt Grothy. A nice little, it was a designed quarterback run, and he got tangled up inside in that right, the lower part of the right shin. They tried to tape him up and have him go. Came back in with just over 2 minutes left in the half, and then he exited again. And Pat Jumas is going to be the guy who finishes this game. I was really impressed with the youngster. Doesn't really flinch in the eyes of pressure. Stands right in there and has done a fabulous job. But his day is done today, and it'll be Pat Jumas for the Bulls of South Florida.
Grothy went 6 for 10, 81 yards and a touchdown. Also ran 7 times for 15 yards. Jumas in as a third down, short yardage, third down and the 2. Third down carry, Jumas will take it, and up to the first down marker. The Coles' his own name, that was Brandon Setzer, who moved in and put the hit on him. Jumas looks like he got enough for the first down.
Yeah, he was the guy, led them to their first bowl game last year against NC State, and they were shut out in that football game, 14-0, but he's got experience. He's had a lot of plays coming into this season at the quarterback position. It's just they found a diamond in the rough in Matt Grothy, but I'll tell you what, he can make plays with his legs. We talked about what they need to do with him in the lineup, and they're going to give him some easy, quick throws, which we saw the screen pass to Ian Randolph, the nice little quick pass out wide, and then there, make some plays with his legs to go along with it.
Now they've got a fourth down situation. This has been a good down for them on the day, as South Florida's gone 3 for 3 in fourth down situations. And no reason you would think not to try it again here once that ball gets spotted.
Yeah, I never argue with a coach. If you want to go for it on fourth down, you have the lead and you're across midfield, hey, it's four down territory. Hey, no argument whatsoever about what Jim Leavitt is doing here with the football.
They'll play Williams as the lone setback here. Quarterback rush was used earlier for a first down, and the freshman Grothy was in there. Let's see what Jumas does with this at quarterback. That's 6 yards back in the backfield. Another quarterback keeper, and that's going to be a first down. Just charges off to that left side. That's where they have run it today when they've wanted that short yardage.
Yeah, they're going behind the first-year starter in Matt Huners, the left guard there, and big Mark Dial out on the outside at right tackle, getting some tremendous push on a couple of different occasions in short yardage situations, fourth and ones for this South Florida team, and they're coming up with some positive stuff.
They get the first down, first and 10. On the come around, it'll be carried back inside to about the 33, Amari Jackson. Jackson has been involved in that play a couple of times. Wide receiver, tackled by Fred Wilson. Amari Jackson, pick up a little bit. East Carolina player down on the field here. That will draw the whistle and stop the clock here in the third with 11:34 left to go.
And you see the big fellow, whenever they reach for the lower part of that leg, well, that really gives you some concern and a great deal of pain. Just hope that that he can get himself up and get back into this football game.
That one's going to hurt a little bit. You'll be helped. That's C.J. Wilson, who's going to be helped to the sideline. Todd Harris.
Well, Gary, during halftime, I had a chance to talk with Coach Skip Holtz of Eastern Carolina. He said, you know what, we are getting beat in all facets of the game. Scheming, they're hitting us with waggles. They're getting us on the defense. He said, our linebackers, our running backs, we have to be about positive yards. And that so far, we have not done that. I told him, I said, at halftime, your father voted you guys the most feel-good team of the year. He said, you know what? I don't even care about that. I got a problem of my own right now.
Papa's going to have to wait on that one. A second down. Williams on the carry. Got stymied. Tried to come back this way. And nowhere to go. He will be thrown for a loss. Benjamin Williams taking down. You can bet this defensive unit now. King on him. Chavez, Wendell Chavez, number 97, has been in on a lot of tackles. He's a junior. 6'2", 280. This team has spent a lot of time out there on defense. East Carolina has in this football game, facing all kinds of spreads and wide running plays that Jim Leavitt's team has thrown at him here in this ball game. That'll bring up a third down and eight. Florida State, Lomas looking out of the pocket. It is caught, 30-yard line, not enough for the first down.
And that's what they wanted to do when he got hit for the touchdown pass by Amari Jackson over the top, was keep things in front of you. Nice little curl route on the outside, but you want to get to the depth of that first down marker, and you'll see him work into your screen right here, hook up, and the ball is on time, which is kind of a thing. If you've been sitting around most of the half, like Pat Jumas, timing is an important thing offensively. Now they get themselves in another fourth down in short situation. Have no argument right here going for it like Jim Leavitt.
Yep, try it again. It's worked all day long for him, so why not keep it going? Leavitt going down the sideline, wants a timeout. He may have a reason not to keep it going. 4 for 4 in fourth down conversions. Whether or not he wants to do it here and what he wants to call, he wants time to think about it. South Florida up 24-7. We are in Birmingham, Alabama, and thanks for joining us for the inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl here in the holiday season on this beautiful day. Fans here who have made the trip, both for folks from Tampa, for the University of South Florida, and East Carolina. Now they're going to go for it here. It is another fourth down.
Watch for the quarterback draw here, and a lot of people spread out in the middle of the field with Pat Jones.
Wilma's got a lot of room, waits, gets the block, and a big hole and a big hit. He will get the first down, down to the 21-22-yard line. Man, did he have some room to run. Pierre Bell moved in on the hit.
Well, they had everybody spread out, and he just kind of could sense it coming. And not wanting to take a gamble with Pat Jumas in the passing game, you knew that he was going to carry the football, secure it, get yourself into the line. That big offensive line getting tremendous push up front for Pat Jumas and Jim Leavitt offensively.
Playing in the Big East this season, they averaged overall 23 points per game, which was 67th in the rankings. They have put up 24 already in this one. Jumas on the handoff. Looked a little awkward, and flags. Everything goes flying down there. There was a fumble, and it's recovered by East Carolina. That flag was for a marker on the fumble that came in the middle of a pile down there. And there's a big turnover for East Carolina.
Yeah, before he gets himself on the ground, it is out. Ricky Ponton puts it on the floor, and all of a sudden it's a scramble for the football. You see it right there. The football comes out. He's trying to reach. He knows that it's out. And now a lot of purple jerseys are around the football. I think it may be Scotty Robinson, number 53, the big defensive lineman, who comes up with it. for East Carolina, but that may be the shot in the arm that they've needed to get themselves back in this football game.
They're going to have to wait a minute, because now we're going to have an official review on the replay as to whether or not he was down before this football came loose.
I think it's out. I think it's out, and there's so many bodies around this when you're looking at it from a replay standpoint that it's going to be hard to determine whether that knee was out and the football simultaneously comes out, if it's already out, because it's out over in this area of the field already. So I'm not sure there's enough video evidence to overturn the official's decision on the field.
We will wait. We have had a number of official reviews here in this football game on some close plays. Was the knee down?
Yeah, you'll see the knee come down right there, and you'll see it's just about on the ground, but you don't know if the football's loose. It's so crowded in that area, a lot of bodies, and clearly he's reaching for the football. So I'm not sure. Like I mentioned, it's not enough video evidence to say whether or not that it's enough to overturn the decision of the officials.
East Carolina hoping they're going to get the football back here and give themselves a chance offensively. It would end a big drive for the University of South Florida and would be their first turnover if, in fact.
Boy, it's tough because it looks like the knee, and you see the football at the top of the screen right there, and the knee is just about down, but not quite. And look for it to squirt out. You can kind of see the football coming out in that area as his knee's going to the ground. I think it's out. I think the officials, this decision's going to be uphill.
Marcus Hands was reaching in, number 92, their defensive end, to try and knock that football away. And for Skip Holtz's team, so this is a big call, not only because it gets them the football, but more importantly, it looked like the University of South Florida was on their way to at least three, if not seven.
Well, it didn't take long, so we'll see if my theory still holds true.
We've had a lot of conversations going on with Rick Doan, the referee, today. And he'll go out and let us know.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
So it will be a first down. East Carolina gets the football. First turnover. And a big one. Now we'll see if East Carolina can get this offense going. James Pinckney has been chased all day long as the quarterback got some medical attention in that first half. Looks like they might have been worried about a concussion on his part. He needs to get the offense going here. It'll be carried up to the 30-yard line, 35-40, and up to midfield and out of bounds. Dominique Lindsay, not even listed on the two-depth chart that was given us, has a 29-yard gain.
That's because he was injured. He missed the last five games, and he went out with an injury against UAB. But you're going to see him cut the football back here, start at front side, and a nice block by the tight end to that side. And then all of a sudden, it's off to the races. This is going to do a world of good for East Carolina offensively. If they can just run the football, it will open up a tremendous amount of things for James Pinckney in the passing game.
Lindsay had 27 carries rushing during the season. Pinckney once faked it, goes deep, got a man open, and a flag goes down. Interference will be called on someone. Allison has been in a battle this entire game. Trey Williams, the all-Big East cornerback, was on the bump and run.
Well, they go with a stop-and-go move, and he pump fakes him. James Pinckney's going to give him a pump fake where Andre Allison will turn up the sideline, and Trey Williams is beaten so badly he has no choice but to grab a hold. He was first-team all-Big East and led this team.
On the defense, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Yeah, he led South Florida in interceptions with seven coming into this ball game, but right about here, you'll see him turn out, a little nice little stop and start, and he's got him beaten up top, and it's just a nice little grab and hold by Trey Williams. That didn't look like a whole lot, but it's enough to just draw the flag.
Allison, good job staying with it. So a couple of breaks here on the recovery, number one on the fumble, and now on the penalty, they get a first down at 10. They are in South Florida territory, and the pitch to the near side, carried to the 35, cut back into the 28-yard line. And again, Dominique Lindsay suddenly becoming a very big factor in this offense.
They're going to start the fullback one direction where they started in here, they fake it here, and now you take the tailback, a nice counter move, and you're back to the outside. You show it to the fullback and then kick it out. And if you get outside leverage, all of a sudden you've got a chance to make a big play on the outside. Just kind of loses his footing there, but boy, East Carolina moving the football now, Gary.
In that first half, this is what they could not do. They had a minus six in rushing. Second down and a three. Take that one straight ahead. That's going to be near the first down, up near the 25 or 26 yard line. That's what they were after, was first down yardage. Lindsay coming out of that backfield again, and Skip Holtz is now here in the third quarter, maybe found a running game. And Lindsay may be the leader in it.
And we said that's what they needed to do, was run the football early in this game. And you talk about time. Well, you got plenty of time. You need to establish a running game where there's a threat of it. Then all of a sudden, the play action passes. They clear themselves up. There are bigger holes in the zone because the linebackers have to respect the run when you show it in there to one of those running backs.
They average 121 yards rushing, 230 passing during the regular season. Pinckney back, big rush, dumps it off. It's caught at the 25. Shankwell got it. Court Shankwell of the fullback, and he also got immediately hit. Maybe a half a yard gain on that. That's his first reception of the day.
You know, some of the best plays go for zero yardage or just a yard or two, but just getting that football out of his hands, James Pinckney, and not taking a sack, because that deflates you offensively. There's a letdown on the offensive line, the backs, and maybe a guy missed a block, but just get the football out, and a completion for not hardly anything, but it does wonders for you offensively.
It'll be a second down and a long 9 yards here. East Carolina trying to put one in. They are trailing 24-7. Looking into the corner, loves the lob in the end zone. Incomplete. It was just out of reach of Andre Allison, who had the defender beat by a step.
Boy, they have been about 3 inches from about 125 yards of receiving, because Allison's had his hands on a few that he should have caught. And this one, James Pinckney's going to wish he had it back. Nice release to get back outside. Now, you want to throw the football a little bit further outside, away from the inside defenders where the safety help is coming from, as well as the corner. If he throws that outside, I got a feeling Andre Allison may be dancing in the end zone.
4 for 9, third down conversions. East Carolina needs this one. They've got to put some points up. Big rush. Look out. Oh, what a shot. All the way from the safety position. I mean, he was charging on the fly.
Well, you can't take that sack for a couple of reasons. It lets the offensive line down. You're holding it too long, as well as it pretty much puts you in a bad situation to kick a field goal here on a later down. But right there, you got to throw that football. You see it coming. You know you're going to take a lick, sail that baby into the stands, and come back and fight on fourth down. But I'm telling you what, you cannot take a sack like that if you're James Pinckney.
What a rush by Gassett, who came charging in. I mean, he was a good 30 yards away when he started. They lost 11 on that.
And that's what Skip Holtz is telling him. It took him right out of field goal range.
Brings the ball back to the 35-yard line. A high boot on the punt. He's not wanted to go into the end zone. It will roll into the corner and come back out to the 20-yard line. So East Carolina, an opportunity after they recovered a fumble. Looked like they were going to get some points. That big hit did away with that. 24-7.
ESPN2 College Football, the PapaJohns.com Bowl, is brought to you by Acura. Acura Advance. ESPN Game Plan. Buy your bowl game package on ESPN.com's Game Plan online and catch over 20 bowl games live and on demand. And PlayStation 2. Live in your world. Play in ours.
Saw this earlier. Had no idea what it was. Decided we ought to find out. This is the Roman god of fire, the Vulcan statue on the summit of Red Mountain overlooking downtown Birmingham. The largest cast metal statue, I'm assuming, in the world. 56 feet tall.
You tell me you can go up there. There's a fence around. You can go up and walk out on it.
Why?
Get you a nice little look. As you can see, for miles. You got a pretty good view here.
Miles and miles. Thank you to the Who. All right, it is a first down and 10. South Florida. Williams gets bounced, 20, and makes some yardage out of it. That's been his day. He'll take that up to the 24-yard line. What a job he has done, Benjamin Williams.
Yeah, let's go back and take a look at this pass, this sack on James Pinckney. Sometimes when you can just read the safeties, they tell you everything about a defense, and you're going to see the safety get shed. Walk up here. Now, all of a sudden, that tells me that the seams are going to be open. He's got an opportunity to hit a big one up the seam with plenty of time. Got a receiver running wide open. No need to take that sack.
Big hit that ended their drive, and the loss eliminated the chance to do anything field goal wise. Dilmus on the carry. He will be shy of a first down. Gets it up to the 28-29-yard line. Matt Dilmus in as Matt Grothy, starting quarterback, injured and out. Van Eskridge made the tackle. He has been mentioned numerous times. He's been in the backfield.
Well, it's a different South Florida football team with Matt Grothy out. They are more of a running style offense with Pat Jolmes in the game like they were last year. You saw earlier in this game, they threw it on fourth and one with Grothy in the game.
Only 11 seniors on this team. Jolmes looking downfield on the out pattern. That's going to be incomplete on the throw on the sideline and will not get the first down. Amari Jackson was the intended. This program may be one of the best kept secrets in college football. Yeah. Many believe in the next few years, Jim Leavitt and the program he has put together. He's been their only coach, 10th year. This is their second bowl. We said only 11 seniors, and less than half of those were scholarship seniors. The others just ended up being walk-ons coming on. I mean, he's got a real program going and a going institution.
Yeah, he's in an area where he can really recruit. The thing I like about him is he's upgraded the speed on both sides of the field, offensively and defensively. That gives you a chance to stay on the field and compete with anybody.
Peachy has to punt. So Ford had to give up the football. It'll roll to the sideline. And East Carolina is going to take over, so their defense held after the offense could not convert. Now for East Carolina, fighting the clock as well as the University of South Florida. South Florida leading 24-7. They are the Purple Pirates of East Carolina University, and they are on hand in force. Downtown last night, they took over Dave's place. You could not get in the door in downtown Birmingham. As Dave's was taken over by the Pirates of East Carolina, and they were making some noise. All right, it is a first down here. Ball carried straight ahead to the 42-yard line. East Carolina starting. Steven Nichols on the tackle.
Well, he showed Pinckney with a tremendous amount of pressure on him, taking some punishment all throughout this game. Big Ben Moffitt there, and a lot of other South Florida Bulls kind of showing up to get a piece. And right here, the final one is the sack by Louis Gachet, the safety to that side. He has taken a tremendous beating. The last sack, though, I didn't think he had to take. Just throw the football away.
Well, Florida had 31 sacks during the season. Trying to get this running game going. Lindsey straight ahead, twists around. He'll be shy of midfield and the first down. Steven Nicholas again moved in on the tackle, the four-year starter who has led this team in the tackles for a loss this year.
Well, along the offensive line for East Carolina, they've had a lot of shuffling. Eric Graham, who's missed the last two games with a knee injury, and once he went out, a lot of shuffling went on around that offensive line.
Eric Graham is here. They hope he might play.
They started him at left guard, but he was a left tackle earlier in the year, so it just totally reshuffled along the front.
Third down and a two. Third and two. East Carolina needs to keep the football. They'll move it close to the first down marker, and again, we will wait and see. Lindsey on the carry. Carlton Williams hit him. We'll check in with Todd Harris.
Well, Gary, you're talking about USF being one of the programs on the rise. For those of you looking to get a jump on the 2007 college football season, you can go to nationalchamps.net, and they have published their early bird look at the 2007 top 25, where they have the USF Bulls at 25, and by the way, they have Matt Grothy at number 25 on the Heisman watch list. Never too early for that. But I think Andre Ware's number 26 on that list, so you never know.
You're right. You never know.
I turned mine in this year.
First down at 10. Pinckney again under pressure. Again gets hit. Hangs on to the football and gets back to the line of scrimmage. That was Alan Cray, the junior, on the tackle.
Well, you just got to get James Pinkney some quick throws. You see, start to see the frustration in his body language. And you don't like getting beat up back there, and you just want a little more time. Well, guess what? You can help yourself. Get back, get set, read things out, and get the football out of your hands as well. Skip Holtz can kind of help him out as well, get him some nice quick three-step drops to build his confidence early here. But time is certainly against this East Carolina football team right now.
They were sacked, the quarterbacks of East Carolina, only 21 times during the season. Run the draw play when you're getting a big rush. That'll be good up to the 45-yard line on the carry. And again, that is Dominic Lindsay. And he's taken over the offensive work in the backfield. Carlton Williams on the hit.
Well, good call, Gary. You know, you talk about a way to offset a fast defense is to kind of give something underneath as they're rushing to the passer. Now those guys want to eat. They've hit James Pinkney a couple of times. They're wanting to feed off him. Give one underneath to the running backs in the draw play, which you're countering their move. They're rushing up the field. You're coming underneath. You got a chance to pop one.
Lindsay's over 50 yards now in his carries, and they've come here in the second half. On this third down, Pinkney rifles it upfield, and that will be caught and held onto at the 31-yard line by Bobby Good. It'll be a 14-yard gain. Good has already taken one into the end zone in this ball game, and that's another big play for East Carolina.
Well, it's flashes like this that put James Pinkney in the same sentence as David Garrard and Jeff Blake. And you see him make throws like that. Nice curl route, a deep curl route along the sideline to Bobby Good. And a lot of velocity on the football there. Get back, get set. The ball comes out on time. He can make all the throws.
38th consecutive start for the three-year starter, Pinkney, at quarterback on the option play. Decided not to option it and gets gang tackled at the 29-yard line on the first down at 10, maybe a gain of a yard. He had nowhere to go with that one. Both teams have struggled to find any way to turn a corner on these defenses in this game, and East Carolina in particular has not been able to get outside. That's Woody George.
Yeah, they need to get themselves at least a field goal here going into the fourth quarter as we approach the fourth quarter, because then it'll put them two scores down where you can really hold and tie this football game up and make it interesting somewhere in the fourth quarter.
It is a second down and nine. Pinkney, the two receivers to the left side this time. They've got another blitz on. Looking again to the end zone, his favorite target, Allison. It is incomplete. And again, locked up with Mike Jenkins. He's had double coverage almost all day on Andre Allison, number two. And Pinckney's not been able to get him open.
All right, see a little Pinckney-Garrard comparison here. And you see the yards and touchdown passes and just kind of approaching him. Pretty much more completions for James Pinkney than David Garrard, but Garrard's a guy that I really like. I thought Jacksonville made the absolute right decision in inserting him into the lineup over Byron Leftwich. He gives him an element of speed in terms of being able to make plays with his legs.
6 for 12 and third down conversions for East Carolina. Pinkney way back, big rush, and it gets blocked and it's incomplete. What a day he is not having. This linebacker front four group for the Bulls of South Florida have really put the heat on. Joel Miss was in there, and Aaron Harris.
Well, you talk about maybe arguably the best trio of linebackers in terms of speed in the country. Moffitt, Nicholas, and Patrick St. Louis on the outside. But they can get to you. They drop well into coverage. Some of the time they can lock up and play slot receivers man-to-man. They've got so much speed at that position.
Ryan Doherty will be doing the holding. Ben Hartman, the kick is up, and it is no good. A 46-yard attempt by Hartman off to the side. The freshman unable to convert it, so they get nothing out of it with 11 seconds to go here in the third. This telecast available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma. On the one side, the Bulls, 24-7. And that's not Ditka's team. On the other side, it's not been a good day for the Purple.
That kind of spells it all for East Carolina right there. I'm going to take me a little nap.
This is a program that started in 1932. It's their 13th bowl game. Their last one was back in 01. They are 7-5 in bowl appearances. Trying to rejuvenate under Skip Holtz, and this is his second season. That's going to do it. They're going to let the clock run out here in the third quarter. And we end up the third the same way we were at the half, as it remains a 24-7 lead as the Bulls of the University of South Florida are trying to put away their first bowl win ever. They are a quarter away from getting that done. Man right there is the leading tackler, solo tackles and overall, Ben Moffitt, linebacker, whose responsibilities go well beyond the football field.
My name is Ben Moffitt. These are my two lovely kids, Trevor Moffitt and Rylan Moffitt. First, you got to keep it in order. You know, you got to have your family first and things like that. I try to just spend as much time as I can, you know, with my kids and my family. My favorite Christmas memory with my kids right now is just getting up on Christmas morning and being able to see my kids' faces when they see, you know, what toys, you know, they got under the Christmas tree and opening them, and they're just so excited and just to see the joy on their faces.
Well, you see there where he's got about an hour commute to from home to campus and then back again. Both ways are an hour. And I was asking, what do you do during that time? He says, that's kind of my downtime. A lot of responsibilities between school, football, and family for Ben Moffitt.
That'll take up the time. Dilmas looking. He's got to heave the long bomb. It is up for grabs, and it is incomplete all the way down to the 30-yard line. Amari Jackson, the intended. Casey Ross getting up off the ground. He's got four interceptions on the year. Ross making his 24th consecutive start.
Yeah, and Amari Jackson does a good job of turning defensive back in this situation, because Casey Ross had an opportunity to pick this football off. And then all of a sudden, it's Amari Jackson coming over the top and making a tremendous play to just knock it down.
That'll bring up a second down and a 10. So South Florida, rather than running the football, letting the clock run, putting that ball up in the air here to start this drive. This time it'll be taken straight ahead, nowhere to go, line of scrimmage. That is Benjamin Williams. Todd Harris.
Well, Gary, I had a chance to talk with the Eastern Carolina Athletic Director Terry Holland, formerly the head coach and athletic director of UVA, so he knows something about winning programs. When the names start swirling around about coaching changes, Skip Holtz's name was not in the mix for any specific program. But Terry Holland decided it was time to get him the contract that he deserved. He just signed a very nice contract that'll keep him at the University of Eastern Carolina for till the year 2011. So ECU has their man. He said that's just part of their program of building a winning way. He's the guy for ECU. And let me just float, Andre Ward, Alabama has a nice ring to it, doesn't it?
He's Alabama bound. Oh, we're promoting here. The near side, it is caught at the 36-yard line and out of bounds. That is Amp Hill. One of the things of note, they've had three coaches on the payroll at East Carolina until this past summer. Now they've only got two. John Thompson, a former coach, is still on the payroll getting paid, along, of course, with Holtz, their current coach. Todd?
And the reason why we couldn't speak with him, Gary, he has got laryngitis. He said, I could speak for him, which is a dangerous thing. And it's also East Carolina University. I don't know who would say it the other way.
I don't either. Our attendance here, 32,023 on hand for this inaugural PapaJohns.com Bowl. This punt will be a line drive kick hitting at the 30 and all the way back to the 20. Flags flying all over the place, carried up over the 40-yard line to the 44. Ball squirts free and ahead. East Carolina will retain possession. Travis Williams with an interesting jaunt on that return.
He's going to get a little extra added on to this for a face mask. So East Carolina going to have some pretty good field position to start this fourth quarter, but they have got now time is working against them, and they need some points on this drive, Gary. I mean, points in a very, very bad way.
Personal foul, grasping a face mask, number 26 on the kicking team. 15 yards from the end of the run, automatic first down.
41-yard punt, an 11-yard return. Tack on 15 more on the penalty, and you got pretty good field position for East Carolina University. And here's today's storyline presented by K Jewelers.
Yeah, Benjamin Williams, two touchdown runs in the first quarter, and then Matt Grothy going out with 808 left in the second quarter. You see the rushing yards. Big difference in this football game.
This is the best starting position today for East Carolina, as they have it in Bulls territory. And they've had the ball gotten it to the 24 and the 29 here in the third quarter. Did not score a point. They've been that close, but that doesn't count.
Well, they may try to go up top here. The cup is certainly presenting itself.
Brandon Frank, just the long running back. Pinckney dropping. Another big rush. All day long, it's been a sieve. Downfield, it'll be incomplete. And one more time, Pinckney gets leveled, and he's down on the field. Boy, has he had some black and blues out of this football game.
Well, he wanted to go up top to Philip Henry on a backside post route off the play action. And a good job of covering up over the top. Danny Verpel has played an outstanding football game, but then going to take a big, big shot here.
That is Carlton Williams.
Boy, just one shot after another. He is going to feel it. He's bringing himself out of the game here.
Yeah, he's got that shoulder hanging down. He's 8 for 25. He's been sacked 4 times. And for the second time in the game, he comes out with an injury. And they'll turn again to Rob Cass, the freshman who's made an appearance earlier in this game. Cass is back in. Cass did not get a snap off the last time around. This time he's going to. East Carolina looking for the ball in the air. Here they come. He drops that one off, completed on the screen, down to the 30-yard line, into the 20 and out of bounds. Brandon Fractious, the running back, and credit Cass. He comes into the game and gets welcomed by a horde of South Florida uniforms.
We talk about draws and screens for a very aggressive defense, and a good job there of drawing the defensive lineman to him, Rob Cass, and then flipping one underneath to Fractious to make a play right there. Nice timed up play, and now I can't wait on the big grunts to get out in front of me. I got to go. Matt Butler taking a little bit too long for Brandon Fractious.
That's a 26-yard gain, and East Carolina's got a shot now. Can they put it in the end zone? When they get in these positions, they've stalled. That'll be carried straight ahead. Not a lot of running room. Fractious fumble. Who got it? Who got it? There was a fumble in there, and I think that may have been picked up by the Bulls. They did. South Florida's got the football back. Another turnover. Jolmis was in on the hit to free it up, and it looks like the recovery will go to Woody George, 96.
That's another. It goes back to my point about the good running backs and the great ones. The great ones know that sometimes the big holes aren't going to be there. I'm just going to take what it is that's available. The good running backs or the average guys always try to pop or force the big play on a defense, and they wind up running behind the line of scrimmage, and then all of a sudden you get guys reaching for the football, trying to strip you. You're up too long in a crowded area. 9 times out of 10, something bad's going to happen, and it happened right then to East Carolina.
Fractious has had a couple of fumbles. That one he never got a very good handle on at all. And he walks off, head down. And again, that's another chance for East Carolina. They've been to the 24, the 29, and the 16-yard line of South Florida, and they've not put a point up. There is an official review going on now as to whether or not that fumble ruling will stand.
That's a fumble.
No question about that one. Well, we have a moment. We were talking about Kay Jewelers a moment ago. Megan Powell is celebrating a birthday today. I'm sure hoping something out of Kay Jewelers shows up in her stocking. Happy birthday to Megan. Sing a song.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday
to you.
Happy birthday, oh,
happy
Megan.
Birthday.
Both sidelines will be taken down as they're not working.
All right, the communications lines upstairs to the coaches apparently not working, and if it doesn't work on one side, the other side has to give them up. Either that or they heard us singing and decided cut all mics.
That's it.
Cut them all. So Jim Leavitt over there taking his headset off. It's the near sideline apparently that's not working for East Carolina. And so no one's allowed to use them until they get them up again.
Jim Leavitt trying to work his until the officials come and get them from him.
Now they're checking to see whether or not it is working on the near side or not. Try it again.
317, please.
And they want to reset the clock. So Skip Holtz puts that headset back on. Maybe they've reconnected.
Just a frustrating ball game so far for East Carolina. You mentioned it. A couple of opportunities to put some points on the board, and they just haven't. They've got 7 in this game, but that was very early in the football game, and it's some turnovers, sacks. Oh, that's really, really killed momentum for them.
Pinckney on a 48-yard pass to Bobby Good that came 5:04 the first when they were down 14-0, made it 14-7. Williams has had a couple of touchdowns on runs in this game. Amari Jackson, 37-yard pass. Matt Grothy, the quarterback for South Florida, who's now out of the football game with the injury. And we've had a field goal of 38 yards by Alvarado of the Bulls. And there is Pinckney on the sideline, who came out and does not look like he's going to be going back in.
Yeah, it just seemed like every scoring opportunity there was either a sack when they were going in that took them out of field goal range or made the field goal longer than it should have been, and then fumbles going in, things like that. Boy, they turned the corner for them, or they put the other team in a position to really, really capitalize.
Gilmus is in at quarterback. They go on the near side. He keeps it and will come to the 20. Falls forward to about the 23, 24 yard line. Gilmus faked. Pretty good move. Travis Williams took him down.
I think that's making something out of nothing. It was a miscommunication between Pat Gilmus and Benjamin Williams. He's going back telling him about it, but that's a pretty good game for a busted play. And that's experience at the quarterback position. Don't try to force it and hand it off in there because the guy clearly not ready for it. I'm just going to try to make a play, and it turns out it was blocked up pretty good.
Gilmus appeared in 7 games during the year, rushing-wise, carried 25 times. Gilmus in at quarterback here with a 2nd down. 9 yards on that last play. Gilmus will come with the option and keep it. 30-yard line, 35. And he'll bring it down to about the 40, up to the 44-yard line before Fred Wilson puts the hit on. Well, you know something? It's tough to have Matt Grothy out of there, the great freshman quarterback. But what a chance for the senior in his final football game to be playing. Even tougher when the senior on the other side, Pinckney, looks like his game and career is going to be finished college-wise as he is leaving with that left arm being frozen against his side.
And I'll tell you what about Pat Gilmus. He had his position. He lost his position because he was injured. He could have gone in the tank. But what a luxury it is for Jim Leavitt to have a guy with experience like that running your offense and playing in a bowl game when you have to rely on him, because he could have gone in the tank mentally.
Yep.
But he didn't. He hung in there. He supported Matt Grothy throughout this season. And now you find yourself inserted back in the lineup and your teammates having to count on you to pull them through.
That was Williams on the carry up to midfield. Keep in mind, this is the final football game for these seniors, some of whom may play in some all-star games later on. But for these respective teams, the seniors are finishing up their career, and that is a very tough way for Pinckney to have to go. He is out of there. He will head off. James Pinckney, the senior. He was a 3-year starter and played 38 consecutive games, including this one today. Williams nowhere to go on that one as he trips down at about the original line of scrimmage. They will back that one up. He's had a very busy day. Career day in all departments. Carries, yards, a couple of touchdowns. And right from the get-go, he was the running attack for the South Florida football team.
Coaches just describe him as that he is just a hard worker. Every day shows up for practice as a walk-on and just gets it done. I mean, just kind of persevering, pushing through, and working harder than the next guy.
He's had 14 carries, 60 yards, and 2 TDs for Williams in this game. A 3rd down, long yardage, 3rd and 9. Gilmus over the middle, man open and down as they move that ball into 1st down territory. That is S.J. Green. That is his first reception. A 4-year starter at the receiver position gets 15.
Yeah, possession type receiver who blocks extremely well down the field. But here you're going to see him work in the zone area. Now, I find a soft spot, kind of throttle myself down and let my quarterback take me where he wants to with the football, because he's seeing where the defenders are right there. He sits S.J. Green down in the hole in the zone.
62nd career reception for Green. 1st down and 10. Williams ahead. And he will carry that ball down to about the 34-yard line. Flournoy on the hit. Jamar Flournoy, we haven't heard much about. Number 6 out there. He's been a 2nd on the team in tackles with 67. Their leader in solo tackles. And he's got a lot of family members here. He's from about 100 miles away in Valley, Alabama.
Yeah, he's played some linebacker, moved to free safety from the linebacker position.
We'll bring up a 2nd down and 5. And carried straight ahead. Not enough for a first down. A little shy of the 30-yard line.
I tell you, I've been really, really impressed with Benjamin Williams. When they get him pointed downhill, and not a big guy, 5'7", 190 pounds, and has really run well between the tackles. We saw what he could do when he gets in the open field. He's got a gear to take it the distance, just a sophomore. So he's got a lot of playing time and a lot of carries left in that frame.
Not only looking to equal the season high in wins for this team at 9, if South Florida could get it, but doing it with youngsters. Nowhere to go that time for the quarterback. Tillemus on the carry, got taken down by Marcus Hands. But you've got a freshman quarterback who had a tremendous year. You've got a line that's made up of sophomores. You've got sophomore, junior starting in that line offensively. You got a freshman quarterback playing. And you've seen the running back, Benjamin Williams, today is only a sophomore. There's Grothy, the quarterback on the far side, is out of the game with the injury, but he will be coming back, obviously, for some years. And for Jim Leavitt's team, that's a lot to build with.
Yeah, a lot of underclassmen. The two tight ends, Blakely and Gordon, will be gone, but S.J. Green, they'll lose him to graduation, but a lot of underclassmen, sophomores and juniors in the receiver positions as well. They'll have Taurus Johnson back in the slot, and they'll lose Ian Randolph, but a lot of experienced players coming back for Jim Leavitt in this South Florida offense.
You know, former East Carolina quarterback David Girardi, we had talked about, and former Marshall quarterback Byron Leftwich are now teammates. Jacksonville, 5 years ago, they played an historic game. We'll look at it when we come back. The 2001 GMC Bowl flashback. Marshall's Byron Leftwich, East Carolina's David Girard, battled in the highest scoring game in the history of a bowl, 38-8. After Girard's 6-yard run, Leftwich led an attack, though what a comeback. Tie it up at the end of regulation. Double overtime. Leftwich striking again, the game winner. Oh my gosh, Steve Logan could not believe it. 64-61, wow. Marshall over East Carolina. Over 1,100 yards in that. Leftwich 576, Girard 201 total and two TDs. Mercy. That's points.
They threw it around a little bit.
Yes, they did. But what a comeback. All right, Justin Teachers come in. They got a big spread offense here on this punt attempt for South Florida after they called the timeout to talk about it. Clock still ticking down. They're letting it go to the bitter end here. They want the clock to run out. And in fact, they're going to do exactly that and take the 5 yards.
Here's something for you. I never understood why coaches take the 5 yards. Because you know why they're trying to allow the time to run out, to get themselves better positioned to down the football inside the 10-yard line. So why would you make it comfortable for the punter by taking the 5-yard penalty? Never understood that. And you figure out the answer to that when you get back with me on it.
Answer this one. Why is he looking up at you like that?
I don't know what he's doing. Wave at him
or
something.
He's got one arm covered. He's got one of the eyes covered there. I mean, what?
Hey, I'm looking back at my binoculars down at him. I don't know.
All right, let's try it again. Standing back this time near midfield. Snap. Goes to the corner. Wishes he hadn't taken the penalty. Could have used the other yards. It goes out of bounds at the 20-yard line. All right, let's check in with Ron Franklin.
Welcome to Lubbock, Texas. Two nights before Christmas and on the brink of history. Bob Knight goes for win number 879 today, which will tie him with Dean Smith for the most wins in college basketball. History in the making this afternoon. Texas Tech and Bucknell coming up right after football. Now, let's go back to Gary Thorne.
How much do you think Bucknell would like to win that game?
Oh, I tell you what, it got them figured for not showing up. Just roll the balls out there and give them a victory.
That will be carried by Chris Johnson. There you see what's the milestone, the most NCAA career victories held by Dean Smith. Bobby Knight's got a chance to tie him with a win today. Adolph Rupp of Kentucky fame. The game coming up today right after our game here on ESPN2 at 4:30. We'll see how they do. And a whistle before the snap. East Carolina. They've got 7 points, and those came early in this football game in that first quarter. Nothing since, even though the ground game and passing game have been better. Does he want to become a spotter in his next life?
No, I think what he's doing is he's using binoculars to look up for the signals from the booth from Rich Rochelle, who is now calling the defenses for Wally Burnham, who is not at this game. And now Patrick St. Louis is looking up there, getting the signals, and he's giving it down to the sideline. That's what's going on.
That's because the headsets aren't working.
That's right, and the headsets are out. Innovative.
So they're going with binoculars to find their defensive coach upstairs. On the carry to the right side, it'll be a first down up to the 32. Dominic Lindsay, 8 yards. He has had a wonderful second half. Lindsay, who did not start the game, and some question about how much he'd be able to play, but he's become their leading rusher.
I tell you what, he has, and he was injured the last 5 games, which you see right there, the binoculars, using all of which is at your disposal right there. That's pretty creative, though. I'm going to look up, get the signal from the defensive coach in the booth, and then signal it in down on the sideline.
Trouble is, they couldn't find the coaches. That ball is caught and fumbled. It will be recovered by East Carolina at the 40-yard line. They're saying incomplete. And Rogers does not like it. That ball looked like a possession had been had on that with Kevin Roach.
It looked like a catch, a put away, and a couple of steps. Good call.
Yep.
He's kind of spinning around. That's a good call.
Got to have possession.
You know, it looked from that angle like he had the football and was trying to dodge the blow that was coming, but he was actually still juggling the football. It wasn't put away. And I think that's an excellent call on the part of the officials.
So it will bring the ball back at a second down and a 10. Rob Cass is in there at quarterback. James Pinckney, his day at quarterback in his career, completed with the injury. That is taken incomplete, out of bounds up near the 40. Andre Allison was the intended receiver. Mike Jenkins has done a heck of a job with that coverage on Allison today.
Yeah.
Allison double teamed. He's only 3 receptions and 24 yards for Andre Allison, who averages 68 a game.
Well, Mike Jenkins has certainly won or gotten the better end of that exchange, because they started mouthing at each other early in the football game, and he's held Andre Allison pretty quiet throughout this afternoon.
They have done that. The South Florida team held opponents to 18 points per game, 24th best in the NCAA. Carried near side and brought up to the 40-yard line. Good rush by Dominic Lindsay. Lindsay on his 9th carry of the game has just taken over in that regard here in the second half. 9 carries, 71 yards.
It's 4-down territory. You got to go for it here. It's 4th down and 2. You're trailing by 17. Every opportunity you can, you've got to take a shot at it.
East Carolina with a football. They'll run that one straight ahead, and that'll be brought up to the 47, 48-yard line. George Selvey moved in to put the hit on. They will stop the clock, as that is enough for a first down. Give credit to the South Florida defense. Their linebackers in this game have shown exactly what they showed all year. They're the 3 leading tacklers. They've been involved in all kinds of plays. They had hoped to put pressure on the quarterback with their front four. Their front four has done that all day. Pass over the middle, completes it, and that'll be down to the 39-yard line. Kevin Roach. Kevin Roach on the reception, and let's check in again with Todd Harris.
Well, you look on the back of the socks of Patrick St. Louis, number 54. He's got a giant WB on the back, and that is in honor of their defensive coordinator, Wally Burnham, who you talked about, Gary, unable to make it today because of the passing of his mother. And like you, we send out our best wishes to him and his family.
Yep, very tough day for them and for the players who dearly love him. That is Lindsay again on the carry, and he'll have about 9 on that one as he brings that ball down to the 31-yard line. Dominic Lindsay, 5'10", 212. What a job he has done. There are the Sox, and there's the Wally Burnham initials. Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator, in fact, is from Pell City. Went to work in a cotton mill near here at the age of 16. Came up the hard way. And very tough for him to lose his mother this morning and unable to make this football game, obviously. That'll be close to a first down at the 30-yard line. And the timeout will be taken with 5:21 left to go here. Timeout by the officials. They want to take a look and see whether or not that was reached.
Well, they're going to reach a situation here for East Carolina where they're going to have to start taking some shots down the field and try to score and get some points on the board rather fast. And you know, they're running the football. We needed that early in the second half. Now you've got to abandon the game plan and start taking some chances.
For East Carolina and Skip Holtz, the game's been kind of backwards. The running game they needed in the first half didn't come around to the second half.
Well, what happens is now you've allowed South Florida, where they're playing more zone coverage, and they're dropping guys back into coverage, and you're finding some running lanes and some soft spots. They'll give you that because it's going to milk the clock. Whereas earlier in the game, a lot of bodies around the line of scrimmage bringing pressure and creating havoc and taking away the running game from them.
Cash back out there, the redshirted freshman quarterback, first down at 10. A little look in, it's caught, and a big hit and held on to near the 20. Jamar Bryant on that catch, another freshman. And I'll tell you, hanging on to that football, that shows you got something right there.
Well, they say he's got the best hands on the football team, decent speed, and he'll be a big-time player here at East Carolina.
They get a second down and very short yardage here. They've got a look to the end zone. Cass rifles it, completed. The defender fell, and it'll be down to the 3-yard line. Defender fell down, and Steven Rogers was wide open. Now he's the leading receiver on this team with 21 coming in. He gets 18 yards.
Boy, Cass has looked pretty good. I mean, he came in only completing 36% of his passes, but he's thrown some nice shots in there to a couple of different receivers.
That is the first catch for their leading receiver, and a timeout is going to be taken by South Florida with 4:36 left to go. One of the best drives we've seen on the day for East Carolina. Chance for a TD here. They're trailing 24-7.
ESPN2 College Football, the PapaJohns.com Bowl, is brought to you by Papa John's. Order your next pizza online at PapaJohns.com. The Lexus December to Remember sales event, now through January 2nd. And ESPN Game Plan. Buy your bowl game package on ESPN.com's Game Plan online and catch over 20 bowl games live and on demand.
Beautiful sunset coming here in Birmingham, Alabama. You should take a look at downtown, visible here from the side of the stadium here at Legends Field. And the 12th play of this drive coming up for East Carolina. They have had opportunities here in the second half. Four other times to get themselves in, not been able to score. Dominic Lindsay is in the backfield, looking back near side, and another big play by the defense of South Florida, Steven Nicholas.
Well, I tell you, just the ability, the speed in which they close on the football is just tremendous. And he is a senior, one of the few that they're going to lose to graduation, but they have got a pretty good core of linebackers led by Ben Moffitt, Steven Nicholas, and Patrick St. Louis.
Now it's going to be a second down, loss of 13. Make that 6 sacks and another loss. There's Moffitt. Leading tackler, total and solo on the year for South Florida.
As if he knew, we just mentioned his name. All of a sudden he pops up. There's a fumble snap in exchange by Matt Butler and Rob Koss. And then Ben Moffitt, those instinctive linebackers like him, they just have a sense. When the football's on the ground, go attack it.
Third down and goal, but the ball way back. They try the Hail Mary in the end zone, run incomplete. Reached for it, tried to keep it in, couldn't do it. And this defense of South Florida, on every occasion when they've been called on here in the second half in particular to get it done, they have. And for the Purple fans of East Carolina, that's about the kind of day it's been.
You know, you talk about Jim Leavitt and his upgrading of the speed on this football team, which allows you to compete and stay on the field with pretty much anyone. And it certainly played out in a huge win against West Virginia, their final ball game of the season. Everybody talked about the speed of West Virginia. Guess what? South Florida matched a man for man.
So fourth and goal from the 23-yard line, and not going to get it. Not even close. It is incomplete. Flag down, however, behind the play, back in the backfield. Line judge making a call here and a late flag. Let's see what this is. Would be without the flag, ball being turned over to South Florida.
Yeah, it looks like it may be a late hit on the quarterback in Richard Kleibert. Big defensive lineman was around Rob Cass. So we'll get
illegal formation against the offense.
That'll do it.
Offsides on the defense. Those penalties offset. Replay fourth down.
We're going to go right back and do it all over again.
Get another chance. There is Pinckney coming out, the starting quarterback, the senior, who was injuring his arm, finishing up his career now, having to watch from the sideline. Rob Cass taking over. Cass comes from a family of quarterbacks. His grandfather was a quarterback at Hofstra, and his father, Dave, played quarterback both at Wake Forest and then transferred on to New Hampshire. So a third-generation quarterback. He's 5 for 8. 73 yards since coming on to take over for Pinckney. Cass back, one more try. Got to get a touchdown or you lose possession. That is going to be incomplete. By the time it got to the receiver, it was already out of bounds, so it will be turned over intended for Rogers. 15 plays, but again, no points. Let's check in with Scott Reese.
All right, Gary, coming up in just a few minutes, Jarius Jackson leading the Big 12 in scoring and trying to get his coach a historic victory. Bob Knight, one away from the Dean, will have Texas Tech and Bucknell.
All coming up right here on ESPN2. So a little consoling going on the sideline.
Yep, I think James Pinckney realizing that this is the final game in the purple uniform. A little motion taking over right now.
Now all South Florida's got to do, hang on to the football. Williams in the backfield. Williams will continue his fine day as he runs up to the 26-yard line. Benjamin Williams on the carry. See the clock ticking here in the first PapaJohns.com Bowl, and it will be not only the first in that regard, but it'll also be the first South Florida Bowl win. In their second try, losing last year, coming back with this young team, having moved up to the big division in 2001, they now add another one of those stepping stones to their program by putting a bowl win away. Jim Leavitt, it'll be his 70th win in the 10 years in charge of this program. Gomez will carry that one to the far side, wanted to avoid the big hit there, gets maybe a yard or two. Gomez on the carry. Clock will stay running with 2:07 to go.
You know, what a fabulous job and a huge turnaround from last season, going 6-6 and being shut out in the Meineke Car Care Bowl against North Carolina State, and then coming in 8-4 with a chance to go 9-4 and post 9 wins for the second time in the program's short history. Jim Leavitt just continues to amaze in that job.
All of these players we had a chance to talk to yesterday in particular, all talked about being part of history. They all have a sense of that, that everything that they do adds to this young program's history, and all of them believe this program is going to become one of the big college football programs in the country.
Yeah, when you talk to Jim Leavitt, he mentioned the fact in 2 years that they've beaten every team in the Big East at least once. And it was kind of the deal was sealed when they beat West Virginia in Morgantown at the final game of the season. So they've gone through the Big East and defeated everybody. I think they're just going to get better and better. They're going to continue to upgrade in terms of speed and size of this football team. And it is a hidden jewel down in South Florida.
Yep, it'll certainly help the recruiting. They wanted to win their conference, didn't get that done, but they did make the bowl. They're going to get a bowl win. They're going to get national recognition. That is Pinckney, who this is a long day. I mean, here's a guy who's been a great quarterback for East Carolina, and you finish it up, and you have to finish it up on the sideline rather than being on the field. Well, here's today's player of the game. It is presented by Capital One.
Yeah, it's Benjamin Williams, 67 yards rushing, 2 touchdowns early in this football game. But every time they needed to have a play in the running game, he certainly provided it through some big blocks to protect his passer as well. So good job by Benjamin Williams, and congratulations.
Justin Tichy will come on to do the kicking for South Florida. And East Carolina's going to get one more chance at it. That'll take a Bulls roll. Be downed at the 23-yard line where East Carolina will take over. Taking a look at it from the other side now of the field for East Carolina, Skip Holtz had hoped. He said our motto all season was being humble and hungry. He said we want to be in the running to someday get into a BCS bowl. If there's a chance to move into the Big East the next time this realignment, we'd like to be there. Said that openly, and had hoped that a bowl win here against the Big East team would make that kind of an impression. Not going to be, as far as that's concerned, as the if anything, it shows just that margin of difference between these two clubs.
He's got a lot of toys in the toy box coming back, and a lot of young players, good talented young players, and some red shirts to throw in there as well. And they're going to be a good football team for a long time.
Bobby Good on the reception. He has had a very good day. Well, we have an opportunity. We never have a chance with all of the games that are done and all of the people involved to say thanks to the people who work on our crews. But we want to make sure here we do that today to send out a very special holiday greeting to all these people, men and women, that we've had an opportunity to work with all
year
long. I mean, we have just had a tremendous crew that has worked with us all season long doing these games. Our camera people who are out here early in the day before getting set up, early in the day to come out and then ask to be artists after they've already worked a full day. They have to come on and do this job, and they are magnificent in the work that they do.
We work behind the scenes, but it is priceless work. They're out very early in the morning getting themselves set up, and we certainly appreciate all that they do for us to allow us to bring the games to you.
Our audio people, the people who help us here in the booth getting set up, the tape people who are in the truck who bring you all the great replays you see, the video people who help us be heard. You may not like them as much as everybody else because you have to listen to us. We sure like them a lot.
Absolutely.
Our graphics people, our graphics operators downstairs, all the numbers that you see on TV that keep you up to date with what's going on in the football game, and all of our help here in the booth with our spotters and statisticians, stage managers. It's a great crew, and we're not done doing football. Some of us. Some will be moving on to do some other games, but we wanted to say thanks to all of them. We love working with you people. It's been a great, great fall of football.
Absolutely. Happy holidays to each and all.
And a timeout will be taken. The Bulls over there from South Florida can't wait to get out on the football field here to celebrate this first bowl victory. But the East Carolina is going to play this thing through with 37 seconds left to go. A 24-7 South Florida lead. Both teams today losing their quarterback because of injuries in the ballgame.
And you see Matt Grothy here just on a designed quarterback run, and it's going to end up in a small hairline fracture down around the lower part of his shin. He was done early in the ballgame. And then James Pinckney a little bit later, see him scrambling around, and he takes a shot on his left shoulder, which put him out of the ball game as well. And two backup quarterbacks, we talk about it, you never know when you're going to have your opportunity. You're always one play away. Stay mentally tuned and sharp, and you just never know when you're going to be back in the ball game.
And both of these backup quarterbacks got the opportunity to be involved in this football game. Running out of time here, East Carolina, 37 seconds left to go. Rob Cass in at quarterback, back at his own 40-yard line. He gets hit as he delivers. It's going to be incomplete. A good hit put on and timely by Ryan Gillum, working out of that cornerback position. Coming up, Bucknell, Texas Tech, and Bobby Knight get the win that will tie him with Dean Smith for the all-time college lead in W's. Coming up, the tip will be at 4:40. The pregame will get you set for that basketball game. 31 seconds remaining on the clock. It is a fourth down. So for East Carolina, last opportunity to keep possession in this game. And that's going to be down the sideline, flag down. It is caught. Nice catch made and up to the 23-yard line. Mike Jenkins was doing the bumping there, but didn't matter. Ball was held onto by Bobby Good, who has had a very good day, 29 yards. He's got the only touchdown pass for East Carolina.
Well, Mike Jenkins called for a couple of different pass interference calls, but they're battling Bobby Good. We talked about or documented the battle with Andre Allison on that
Holding,
side as well.
Number four in the defense. Penalties declined. Results of the play, first down.
Well, a good adjustment on the football as well to come back inside, a ball thrown inside, and put a little air under it to allow your receiver to make an adjustment. And Bobby Good does a heck of a job.
He's got 116 yards worth of passes today, five receptions, one of those for a touchdown. A very solid day for Good, who's coming back from a foot injury. Cass has got it. 23 seconds left on the clock. Goes over the middle, completes it inside the 20-yard line, and knocked down at the 11. That is Kevin Roach. Rob Cass has put on a pretty good show here.
Tell you what, they're going to throw the football around a little bit next year if he indeed wins that job in spring practice, and got a big-time arm and some nice weapons to come back and compliment him with.
Trying to get into the end zone here. That's going to be incomplete. It is the fifth time this half that East Carolina has been in South Florida territory, and they've not been able to come up with anything. Jim Leavitt has already taken the shower. 8 seconds left to go. Yet another milestone for this young football program out of Tampa.
Now, he watched the attempt on Chuck Amato last year in that bowl game to douse him with the water, and this is something he wanted to have happen. He wasn't going to run from it long. Sure. He wanted to have the Gatorade bath happen to him.
Gas looking into the end zone, incomplete off the fingertips, down to 3 seconds remaining to go. Chris Johnson, the intended. Watch Leavitt.
Oh, yeah. Good green stuff.
And cold. And real cold.
He had to run that one off. It's a little bite in the air right now. It's cooled off a little bit, so that's got to be a nice, cool feeling for Coach.
His first and only head coaching job right here is going to have his first bowl win. All right, 3 seconds left to go. Cass again will try to get one into the end zone. That is going to be overthrown, and that's it. The inaugural Papa John's.com bowl is going to go to South Florida 24-7. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Happy holidays, everybody. Rondway Ware, Todd Harrison, all of our crew. I'm Gary Thorne. We're going to take you to Ron Franklin, Lubbock, Texas. I'm Gary Thorne. Sweet dreams.